You are watching ABC's Wide World of Sports.
The 20th century comes to an end with a second-generation driver, Dale Jarrett, celebrating his first NASCAR Winston Cup championship. Enter the new millennium.
The glitz and glamour of Las Vegas world famous trip provides a setting as NASCAR's elite Winston Cup stars prepare to shine. Today, 43 drivers battle 400 miles for $4 million.
Las Vegas, known for its championship fights, and today's battle between the front row starters could be promoted as a grudge match. Scott Pruitt's team wooed away Ricky Rudd's sponsor. Ricky needs a new ride. He landed in the 28, and today he and Pruitt start side by side on the front row.
Las Vegas loves a winner, and winners love Las Vegas.
That makes Jack Roush in this place a perfect match. Roush car has won the last four stock car races here. Jeff Burton and Mark Martin have won the only Winston Cup races here, and that's a pair that could beat a full house.
Live from Las Vegas Motor Speedway, ABC Sports presents live coverage of the third race of the 2000 NASCAR Winston Cup season, the CarsDirect.com 400. Hi everyone, I'm Bob Jenkins. It is a huge sporting day in the city of Las Vegas. Over 125,000 fans have gathered here today, and they could see $1 million given away if one of the top five drivers in last month's Daytona 500 can win here today. He'll win the noble $5 million bonus, and a fan will also win $1 million. But the real story is the weather. The last couple of days have been sunny and warm. Today it's significantly cooler. We have an increase in the wind, and we have a cloud cover. So how will that affect the running of this race? Well, let's find out from our experts. Former NASCAR Winston Cup champion Benny Parsons and the man who helped the Rainbow Warriors and Jeff Gordon win three NASCAR Winston Cup championships. He'll be with us for all of our ABC NASCAR telecast this year, Ray Evernham.
Well, Ray, we keep talking about just how much the weather changes these cars. What kind of changes did the crew chiefs make from yesterday afternoon's practice till the race day today?
Well, besides the ever-critical engine tuning, the overall temperature is down. Brings the engine temperature down. The only way to get the engine temperature up is to put more tape on the front. Put more tape on the front creates more front downforce. A car that has more front downforce turns better, passes better. Looking forward to a good race.
Thank you very much, Ray. Bob, it ought to be very exciting because the weather's going to help.
A lot of factors that will determine who wins today's race. Let's take a look at the Walmart Tire Center starting grid. Ricky Rudd and Scott Pruitt are on the front row. Eight of the top 15 starters have never won a NASCAR Winston Cup race. And Benny, it's a nice blend of young drivers and veterans in the top 15.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. had to be so excited after that qualifying run on Saturday. He was on the pole for a long, long time. As you look back at 16 through 30, once again, Matt Kenseth continues to impress here in the year 2000.
And the remainder now of the starting lineup with provisionals going to Ward Burton, who finished second here last year. John Andretti, Bill Elliott, Kenny Wallace, Kyle Petty, Wally Dallenbach took provisionals, and Darrell Waltrip is the previous champion's provisional starter in 43rd position. So they'll take a couple of more laps. For a lot of people down the street on the Vegas Strip, $1 million isn't much money. Millions are won and lost each day. Four or five competitors, Dale Jarrett, Jeff Burton, Bill Elliott, Rusty Wallace, and Mark Martin, they will take home the noble $5 million bonus if they can be first under the checkered flag here this afternoon.
There's Mark Martin. He'll be carrying the Conseco onboard camera this afternoon. The signal has been given to the field one lap before the green flag. Mike Skinner also has the onboard camera starting back in 20th position. We see the cars weaving back and forth. Ray, they're trying to get those tires clean of debris before the green flag.
Yes, Benny, and with the cool temperatures today, they're actually trying to get a little bit of heat in them because the car tend to slide till that tire gets up to about 200 degrees is the optimum tire temperature.
Dale Jarrett will be carrying one of our onboard cameras, and we have a story breaking on pit road. Jerry?
Well, just prior to rolling off, Dale Jarrett's hood went up on the Quality Care Ford. They had made a last minute engine change this morning in the garage area when Robert Yates, a team owner, found some metal in one of the filters. Now, they thought there may be something rubbing the steering column. They raised the hood, cleared away what they thought might have been the problem with the steering column, and DJ now has, is rolling. No other problems thus far early on here for the 88 car, but a scare for this team here as they rolled off the line just moments ago.
Jarrett, the points leader going into this event, having won at the Daytona 500 last month. On board now with Dale Earnhardt Jr. as he gets set to go from his third starting position. The pace car takes the hard left onto pit road, and we are about to get underway with the CarsDirect.com 400. The 125,000 fans on their feet awaiting the drop of the green flag. They come down at a slow pace. The green is out, and the race is on.
Huge battle going on for fourth spot as Bobby Labonte has that spot. They're three wide down the middle of one and two, and a battle for the lead as Dale Earnhardt Jr. comes off two underneath Ricky Rudd.
Has a good run coming off the second corner, entering turn number three. Earnhardt Jr. gets the lead, and Mark Martin comes with him, dropping Rudd back to third.
We asked Dale Jr. this morning about his car. He seemed to be very apprehensive about the car. He must have loved that first lap.
That is the first lap that Dale Earnhardt Jr. has led in the year 2000. He did lead at Atlanta in the last race last year. Look at this huge pack of cars, three deep off the corner.
And Scott Pruitt, the outside poster, that tide ride right in the middle. Then Robbie Gordon on the outside, Elliott Satter on the inside. You see Gordon takes that spot away from Pruitt. Robbie Gordon, that is.
And Jeff Gordon now is right behind him. That's Michael Waltrip in the black and yellow number seven. Down to the inside of Pruitt. And the 75 car of Wally Dollenbach has been black flagged. He apparently passed a car before hitting the start-finish line. You can on the outside, but if you pass from the inside, it's a penalty, and that apparently is what happened to Wally Dollenbach.
Jim, right in the middle, once again, of a three-wide battle. As Johnny Benson goes by on the outside, Benson on the inside, Rusty Wallace goes by on the inside, and we see some raindrops starting to hit our camera lens.
We have had light rain showers all morning long here at the Las Vegas. Nothing that would halt the race, but just an occasional shower passes over, and let's hope it doesn't get any heavier than it is right now. Well, Scott Pruitt, obviously, Ray, is having problems. He has dropped all the way back from his second starting position back to around the 15th position. Oh, they touched. And up front, it is Mark Martin now getting to the inside of Dale Earnhardt Jr. And at the line, Mark Martin has the advantage by about a half a car length.
Going back to Scott, some of the things that you have to learn as a rookie is what your car is supposed to feel like when you're ready to start a Winston Cup event. And it's hard for those guys to know exactly what that car is going to feel like. And he is going backwards just a little bit.
For a taste of the race, let's check out our Jimmy Dean onboard telemetry. On board with Dale Earnhardt Jr., the miles per hour on the top, the RPM in the middle, and if he should hit the brake, which he will going into the corners, you will see how much braking he will use.
Look at those RPMs, 8,900 I saw going down in turn one. This cool air is making these cars, these engines perform better and accelerating the RPMs. It might be too many RPMs for 400 miles.
Well, Benny, they've been creeping up and creeping up on engine development, and they'll turn those things right around 9,000 RPM for 500 miles. That's about the normal.
And not have a problem.
Good. All right, here's Jeff Gordon doing battle with Rusty Wallace.
Battle back for the 15th position as the Robbie Gordon at 13 is in 14th.
Here comes Matt Kenseth in the yellow and black number 17 car. Behind him is Joe Nemechek, who drives number 33 this year. Robbie Gordon in that multicolored car just ahead of Wallace and Jeff Gordon. And Jeff now heads for the high side of the racetrack off corner number two. Scott Pruitt continues to fall back. He is way back now in the 31st position.
Bob, Scott is driving for a Cal Wells team, a brand new race team in NASCAR this year. So when they came here to test, they worked primarily on qualifying, not on race setup. You see, they got to qualify. They don't have any points from years ago. So they qualified in the front row. But yesterday at happy hour, they were the 35th fastest car in the field, fighting a loose condition. What they're fighting right now, the car very, very loose. They're learning right now. Scott making only his second ever Winston Cup start in a stock car.
Man. Wide and Rusty decided to back off and probably was a wise decision.
Trust me, you want no part of a three wide situation here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Daytona, Talladega, maybe, and Michigan, maybe, but not at Las Vegas.
It is great to see him using that much of a racetrack this early in the race to have two and three grooves. Pretty exciting.
We're watching back for the 16th, 17th, and 18th position, and Mark Martin gives up the lead to Dale Earnhardt Jr., and I don't think it was much of a matter of Earnhardt Jr. taking it away as it was Mark allowing Dale Earnhardt Jr. to go back in front.
Well, Mark took the lead, and when he did not drive away from Dale Jr., he kept looking in the mirror, and that 8 car, that Bud car, was right there, so he said, hey, he's running a little bit faster than I want to go, so let me follow him for a while. He'll get laid back in that draft and just follow and wait for Earnhardt Jr. Hopefully his tires to get on, and he'll retake the lead or try to.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., Mark Martin, Ricky Rudd, Bobby Labonte, and Jeff Burton, the top five, 10 out of 267 laps completed.
The CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC Sports, brought to you by Brewery Fresh Budweiser, official beer of NASCAR. This Bud's for you. Quality care service at your Ford and Lincoln Mercury dealers. And Walmart. Brand name tires, oil changes, and more at your neighborhood Walmart Tire and Lube Express.
Well, the crowd here at Las Vegas is all bundled up and trying to stay dry. Right now, we're in good shape as far as the rain is concerned. However, we do have a very, very cool breeze that's blowing over the racetrack. They're the top four. Dale Earnhardt Jr. leading Mark Martin. Running in third position is Bobby Labonte. And fourth right now is Jeff Burton. Burton, the defending champion of this race. And here comes Martin once again, taking a look to the inside of Dale Earnhardt Jr. You know, Ray, when we go to Darlington in a few weeks, they will wear out a set of tires there in no time because of the abrasiveness of the racetrack. But here it's a nice, smooth racetrack, and I guess the main concern is not tires, but it's fuel. That's when they will have to pit.
That's right, Bob. NASCAR Goodyear brought a real good tire here to Vegas that will run a fuel stop. The one thing they have to be critical about is how much air pressure they build up in that tire. Right now, you'll see Mark, he'll make a run at Dale Jr., and he'll back off a little bit. He doesn't want to build up too much air in that right front tire. It'll make the car push because he knows those tires are going to be on there a long time, close to 100 miles.
A couple of laps ago, there was a very anxious moment for Jerry Nadeau as he went into turn number one. Here is what happened. He got up in the gray so much so that it raised some dust and almost caused him to, in fact, I think he left a mark on the wall.
Well, he just about turned the car around. You want to get really wide, getting in the corner. Watch Dale Earnhardt Jr. as he goes up really wide and goes down in the corner. You want to do that because it will help the car turn in the middle. As we see Kevin LePage in the number 16.
has moved into the seventh position after starting in 14th spot.
And he has a new sponsor on that car this week. Kevin LePage does. We'll tell you who that is in a moment. Meanwhile, look at Earnhardt Jr., who suddenly falls from third back to fourth spot.
I think what might have happened there is when Mark got up behind him, it took a little bit of the air off the spoiler and let him get a little bit loose getting in.
We still see he's turning 8,600 RPMs. Not quite as many, much as many RPMs as he was turning a moment ago. Let's go down the pits.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. had a tough day yesterday. They borrowed two setups from his dad's car. Neither of them seemed to work. Now they seem to have a setup in the car that will work. But we have an unscheduled pit stop on pit road. Michael Waltrip coming in early. Apparently a vibration or a tire going down. He just said four tires on the radio. He came down pit road. He's got rights already. They'll just have to top off the fuel. Now, Waltrip sitting on pit road. The car's not running. He stalled it out. And they get him on his way. Down pit road, Jerry Punch.
Prior to today's race, Jeff Gordon and a lot of the people in the pits here thought, as the caution now being waved to the field, we are being told on the radio that there are raindrops sprinkling all down the backstretch in turn three. I just heard Jeff Gordon say, it is raining, I got rain on my windshield, so the yellow flag waves. This will be a break for Jeff Gordon because this morning they changed two springs on his car number 24, thinking the car would be very, very tight, but it's very loose off the corner. That's why he was sliding back in the field.
He had slid all the way back to 35th position, so this caution is a godsend for Jeff Gordon. The caution out because of rain falling on the backstretch. A little bit of moisture here in the front stretch area also. So Mark Martin had taken the lead from Dale Earnhardt Jr. Jeff Burton now running second, then Bobby Labonte and Earnhardt Jr., who found himself out front for a total of 11 laps, but now has relinquished the lead to Mark Martin. Back with more from Las Vegas in a moment.
This Wide World of Sports update brought to you by Mobile One. Nothing outperforms Mobile One. Here now, Robin Roberts.
As you can see, raindrops there in Las Vegas at the CarsDirect.com 400. We'll get you back out there in just a moment. First of all, college hoops and an important Big East matchup between St. John's and Miami. With the win, which would be St. John's ninth in a row, they would take the top seed in the upcoming Big East Conference tournament. A loss, and Miami would share it with Syracuse. And Eric Barkley, he was back after a second suspension, but Mario Bland ties the game, so they go to overtime. And Eric Barkley has his layup blocked by Elton Tyler, and Miami with the upset. They share the Big East regular season title with Syracuse. They beat St. John's 74-70 in OT. Miami claims the number two seed. St. John's ends up with the third seed for the upcoming Big East tournament against Syracuse, the number one seed in that conference tournament. Appalachian State and College of Charleston, Southern Conference Championship. Tyler Patterson goes the length of the court for the lay-in. Appalachian State can smell the upset, and they do. The first time College of Charleston has lost in the conference tournament. Okay, it's just their third year, but still, Appalachian State is going to the NCAA tournament for the first time since 1979, when Bobby Crimmins was a coach back then. That's our Wide World of Sports mobile update. Back now to Bob Jenkins in Las Vegas.
All right, Robin, well, in the desert about 20 miles north of Las Vegas, we have rain, and that has been the situation for the last few minutes. We have not run any green flag laps. We did have, however, a wholesale pit stop activity, and here they came.
Martin, the leader, brings him down. Bobby Labonte makes a stop.
Those pit boxes are
changes
good.
Four tires. Yeah, we see Mark Martin, the right side is going down on that automobile. Jeff Burton is in, changing four tires.
Betty, you can see the size of these pit boxes is very, very big compared to some of the other places that we've been. Allows the cars to get in and out easily and gives the guys a little bit more time.
As you see, some cars are coming into pits and some are leaving. As Matt Kenseth tries to come down pit road, does a good job. Dale Earnhardt Jr. leaves. See Bill Elliott and McDonald's Ford, he changed two tires trying to get some track position that is so desperate here.
Yes, it really is. And track position here is not only creates a problem with your way behind distance-wise, but again, going back to the aerodynamic downforce, the further you are behind another car creates a push. That push builds up the right front tire, and it compounds the problem.
Let's get a recap on what our pit reporters saw. Here's Jerry.
Mark Martin's pit stop, a very routine stop. Four tires and no adjustments whatsoever on the car. But now Jeff Gordon, as you heard, had been backsliding in the field and had a problem with the car getting in the corner. He was tight getting in and loose coming off. So they came in and pulled a rubber out of the right rear, took this rubber spacer out of the right rear to try to help the car a little bit, and also made an air pressure adjustment so Jeff could have some forward bite coming off the corner, which should improve the car significantly. Bill Weber?
First of all, on Bobby Labonte, uncharacteristically slow, 18.26 seconds. They went down two rounds on the track before he came in third, went out 10th, had a small problem with the jack, but they also lost spots because some guys in front of them took two tires. Rusty Wallace just got four tires and fuel in 17.67 seconds. Rusty says his car is really good. And an update on the seven car of Michael Waltrip, he came in for a vibration. His crew chief told me so far they have not found anything wrong with the tires. John?
As Benny pointed out, Bill Elliott came down, took on only right side tires to pick up a lot of track position. Elliott, one of the drivers going for the $1 million bonus, started way back at the tail end of the field, so they opted for the two tire change. Kevin LePage, who moved his way up into the top 10, took on four tires. They made an air pressure adjustment on the right front. His car was just a little bit too tight in the center of the turn. They were trying to loosen that up, and Dale Earnhardt has started 33rd and has made up about 15 spots out on the racetrack. He took on four tires. They made no changes. Kevin Hamlin tells me Dale is pretty happy with the car right now.
Awaiting the green flag to go back to racing. Let's talk about these pit boxes, Ray, that you mentioned. Daytona, the size of the pit box, 22 by 15. At Rockingham last week, they were 30 by 17. Here, they are 40 by 17.
It just gives you a lot more room to angle a car in. As we noticed at Daytona and Rockingham, guys were jammed in behind other guys, and it was pretty tight getting in and out. You'll see some really fast pit stops today because the guys can line the car up on the marks that they need, and the guys have got some room to work. You know, we should see some low 16, high 15-second pit stops today.
Well, as you can see, the pit crews have brought out the tarpaulins to keep the pit areas and pit boxes as dry as possible.
And they had to take the tarp off the 25's pit as Nadeau comes down. Pedro, watch him making adjustments on both sides of the rear springs, and someone is under. What are they doing under the car there, Ray? Do you have any ideas?
They could be adjusting on the rear sway bar, or they might have a spring rubber caught up underneath there that they're having a hard time getting out. Could be doing lots of things, Benny. Could be checking for damage. I see he probably got into the wall with the right rear. They might have knocked the panhard bar over a little bit and be readjusting the
That 40 feet that Bob talked about is from here all the way back to back here. And I'll look at all the space that Nadeau has in the rear of his car. So you're right, these guys will not have trouble getting boxed in their pit area today.
I would say, Benny, as long as he's been under there, they're probably adjusting the panhard rod. He might have knocked the rear end out of square when he got into the wall.
He did. We can see the damage on the right rear quarter where he hit the wall.
Did hit it pretty significantly a few laps ago when he got up high entering turn number one. Well, the track crews are out there trying to get the track in raceable condition once again. We are still under caution. Kyle Petty, who didn't pit, is the leader. Welcome back to Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Still under caution. The shots from our Pennzoil copter cam, which is hovering over this 1.5 mile facility. And as you can see from their camera lens, and we can't change it like we can the onboard cameras, a little bit of moisture on it. But when we go down into Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s onboard camera, you can see that there is no rain on it. And along the front stretch here at the broadcast booth, we have no rain. So as soon as those trucks, the Dale Earnhardt Jr., just got by, hopefully we'll be able to go back to green flag racing. Let's take a look at how they run here at this 267 lap race. Darrell Waltrip did not pit and is the leader at this point. He's leading for the first time since Richmond in May of last year, with Dale Earnhardt Jr. second, then Matt Kenseth, Sterling Marlin, and Jeff Burton in the top five. 28 laps have been completed. We'll be back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching the CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Welcome back to Las Vegas Motor Speedway and the CarsDirect.com 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race. We had hoped to go back to green. However, there's an object on the racetrack, or there was, and that has delayed the flying of the green flag. And there is the piece of debris right there. Looks like at the exit of pit road. What is that, Ray?
Looks like spring rubber out of somebody's car. Look, three-quarter spring rubber, and it looks like it might be out of number 9 car. It's marked on there, and we'll find out whether it's to the front or rear if Stacy starts complaining here pretty quick.
That little handle is how they jerk when they take the tire off, how they jerk that spring rubber out of the spring.
Let's get a pit update from Bill Weber.
Well, you saw the work going on underneath the 25 car of Jerry Nadeau, and what they did is they went underneath the car and made a sway bar adjustment. You have to do that underneath the car. You can't do it with a wedge wrench or anything like that. They have what they call a sway bar specialist. His name is Tim Nelson. He went underneath the car, made the adjustment, had another crewman yank him out by his feet when they said the pace car was coming, and then Nadeau took off. What they wanted to do was to take some of the load off, so that the driver, Jerry Nadeau, can get in the gas quicker coming off the turns back upstairs.
And here is the incident that has caused all these problems right there up against the wall, leaving the mark and saving the car, though.
And just brushing the tire against the wall, and I'm sure that shifted some things over in that Michael Holligan car.
Down to Jerry Punch.
Front row starter Scott Pruitt had made two stops on pit road during this caution flag a moment ago. Now, he had gone from the second starting spot to about 36 in the field because the car was so loose, he couldn't even use the throttle trying to come off the corner. The first stop they made was for four tires. The second stop they came in, they unhooked the rear sway bar. Ray Evernham, you can explain what that does, but there's Doug Reichert, the crew chief. He made the call to completely unhook the rear sway bar to try to help the race car, which is just slipping and sliding all over the track.
But when they unhook the rear sway bar, Jerry, what it does is just, it's like reducing the right rear spring rate. You hear people pulling spring rubbers out. Reducing or unhooking the rear sway bar just allows the car to have a little softer right rear spring in it.
Scott has dropped all the way back to 35th position from his second starting position. Well, again, we are being delayed as far as the green flag is concerned with a little bit of moisture that continues to fall over the racetrack. Nothing hard, more of a mist, but it is continuing to hold the yellow flag out. The Las Vegas Motor Speedway in the CarsDirect.com 400 under caution because of a little bit of rain here at the Motor Speedway. Up front, the top two rookie candidates, at least right now, in the battle for the Revestis Rookie of the Year honors. The leader is Dale Earnhardt Jr., and running in second place is Matt Kenseth.
As we ride along with Dale Earnhardt Jr., Ray, the fact that he only changed two tires, Matt Kenseth only changed two tires, does that mean they're happy with their car and just decided to try to get track position for the two-tire change?
I think track position was part of it, Benny, but both of those guys might have felt like their car was just a little bit tight. And on a racetrack like this, sometimes if you only take two right side tires, it'll let that car roll through the middle of the corner a little bit better. When you give up that left side grip, sometimes the car will actually get faster.
Well, Ricky Rudd is the winner of the Bud Pole Award for the race here at Las Vegas. He won the pole on Friday afternoon with a new track record. Now he joins Dale Jarrett, who won the pole at Daytona, and Rusty Wallace, who won the pole at Rockingham, as entrants into the 2001 Bud Shootout at Daytona coming up next February. All pole winners in the year 2000 will battle in the Bud Shootout at Daytona next February. And of course, the winner of the Bud Shootout qualifier will also get an entry into the Bud Shootout. And Jeff Gordon is on pit road.
And they're changing right side tires, something they did just a few laps ago. Going around, changing the left side. Ray, why would they be changing four tires when they just did this?
Well, they might have thought a little bit more about what the car was doing, as they said it was tight in, loose off, and they made a spring rubber change, but they might have just decided to make a nut. Well, I see them working up under the left front. They're probably doing another spring rubber change there, and maybe a tire pressure change. Sometimes you just can't fix a car that's doing two different things with one change, so they've thought about it some more. They were at the back of the pack anyway, decided to give up track position and get the car fixed.
Now, Ray, is this long caution period that we're having here, is it good or is it bad? Does it give the...
He's going to get lapped. I believe he's going to get lapped. Is he or isn't he?
No, his paddle looked green.
He did look green.
Oh, he just barely made it out of the pits.
Barely made it out. We see the pace car on the racetrack, and wow, that was close.
That was very close. All right, is this good or is it bad? Does it give the crews and the drivers an opportunity to talk, or is it more bad than it is anything else?
Well, Bob, again, it depends. It gave Robbie and Brian and the guys a little bit extra time to think about what they wanted to do. But by the same token, nobody's really run long enough to see what this racetrack is going to do yet. You didn't have your first set of tires on there long enough. And I really believe this track is going to be a lot different at the end of this race than it is right now. So I just think they need to run some more before they can start making major changes.
You know what, Jeff Gordon and those guys that time, I noticed the lap before that, a couple laps before that, the pace car had started running faster in trying to help let these race cars drive the racetrack out. Normally it runs 55 miles per hour. They had gotten up to about, the speed right now is 80 miles per hour, and Jeff Gordon and the crew was not expecting that. They thought they had a lot more time than they had for that change.
So they continue to try to get the track dry and in racing condition here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We'll take another break and be right back with more. Rather lengthy caution period here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway because of rain. It is raining in some parts of the track, but not everywhere. And what they want to do is just keep the cars out there as long as possible, plus get the jet dryers out to make sure that the water doesn't accumulate anywhere. And they picked up the pace to over 80 miles an hour here. Let's take a look at how they are running. With 40 laps completed, our Napa field summary shows that Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Matt Kenseth are running first and second. Sterling Marlin, Jeff Burton, and Mark Martin are the top five.
How about Ricky Craven started back in the 29th position?
Pole sitter Ricky Rudd has dropped to 13th spot. Here is 16 through 30 now. And Ward Burton has made a pretty nice progress to the front.
Yeah, started back in the 37th position. Dale Earnhardt also going towards the front. As we see, the cars are stopping on the racetrack now. So NASCAR has decided to issue the red flag.
And
slow
here's
the field
the remainder
down.
Of the field summary with Wally Dahlen back, the only car not on the lead lap. Michael Waltrip is at the tail end of the lead lap and the first car in line. Well, Jeff Gordon has been in a couple of times, and each time he's been caught speeding off pit road, but that isn't much of a penalty, Doc.
No, they've struggled most of the day. I'm with Robbie Loomis, the crew chief. And Robbie, you guys began to drop back initially, and we reported you came and took a rubber out of the right rear and made an air pressure change. What were you fighting?
The car's really, we got in the back of somebody there at the start, and we're really tight getting in, especially behind traffic, but the car's really loose at the exit, so we tried to tighten it up. We worked the air pressure a little bit, tried to get it freer getting in the corner.
And you came back in a moment ago and had to leave in a hurry, got caught speeding, leaving pit road, but you had to come back anyway. You're trying to put a rubber in the left front?
Yeah, we're trying to put a rubber in the left front. Like I said, on the entry, the car's pretty tight, so then we noticed the nose beat in there. We're trying to get a little tape on there, too, to get a little more downforce on the front.
The nose is purely cosmetic. There's no damage to the radiator or anything inside?
No, the radiator, all that stuff's fine. It's just a matter of now, you know, you get a lot more air in the front end. It makes it lift a little bit more.
Okay, that's Robbie Loomis, crew chief for Jeff Gordon. They think they may have the problem solved now with a rubber in the left front.
Well, they hope they have the problem solved. It's just there's so many things to do. There's just thousands of different things to do to try to make these cars a little bit better. Changing, putting the rubber in the left front is just one of them.
Under the red flag, the teams are not permitted to work on the cars. They must remain without any work being done on them.
And NASCAR is only allowing two crew members per car to go down and put the cover on the car. As we see Earnhardt Jr. getting out of his car, we see the tarp there. These two crew members will put, they'll put tape on the gas tank to make sure no, the gas where you put the gas in the car, to make sure no moisture gets in there.
And Benny, when you can't go out to your car, what you want to do is if you want to communicate to your driver, you'll walk over and see him or get him to come over and see you, and you'll start to try and make a plan for the rest of the race. If your car is not good, as they are with the 24 car, they're going to work on options. If it does this, here's what we're going to do. If your car is good, you're going to start to decide, hey, what's our fuel mileage look like? Do we think this race is going to go all the way?
Watch Tony Stewart go up and talk to his teammate, Bobby Labonte, checking out what his car's doing, trying to see Tony talking to Bobby. Okay, and what's your car doing? Now, mine's doing this, and this is great strategy to get together and try to figure out what their car is doing and what they can talk to the crew about changes they'll make on the next pit stop. They'll start using their hands in a minute to describe, see,
That's a driver thing, huh, Benny?
Yeah, you got to use your hands to tell what the car's doing.
Bobby Labonte currently running in eighth position, and his teammate Tony Stewart right behind in the ninth spot as the red flag is out.
See, Ricky Craven climbing from his car. The purple number 16 is Kevin LePage. First time you've seen that color this year.
Mentioned a little bit earlier that he does have a new sponsor on that car, and it is FamilyClick.com, one of the family websites. There is Ricky Craven, who's taking a drink of Gatorade as he's awaiting the weather to move over the racetrack and the track to be put back in racing order. Joe Nemechek also is outside his car watching the weather. But for right now, we have 40 of the 267 laps completed as Kenny Wallace runs across the infield grass. We'll be back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
The CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC Sports, brought to you by Conseco and Polaris, proud manufacturer of the Sportsman 500, the best-selling automatic ATV in the world.
Forty-one laps have been completed out of the 267 here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway in the CarsDirect.com 400. We are under a red flag condition because of rain. Not a hard rain by any stretch of the imagination, but it is raining a little bit at some point on the racetrack.
You see all those crew members, all those drivers, all those NASCAR officials standing down there, and not one of them has an umbrella.
Yep.
So obviously it isn't raining. It's just raining hard enough to be aggravating.
And let's explain why Jeff Gordon got caught speeding twice coming down pit road to beat the pace car out. Let's explain why the penalty wasn't really significant at this point.
Well, the penalty is you go to the end of the longest line. Well, guess what? That's exactly where he was going to be to begin with. And also, NASCAR speeding up the pace car caused Jeff Gordon to have to speed down pit road. So I think that NASCAR saw that and said, look, you know, there's no way that we can penalize this team for speeding down pit road, because we've created that problem by making the pace car go faster.
Plus, Benny, the alternative to him not speeding, he would have went a lap down. So it was either speed and start at the tail end, or not speed and go a lap down and have a lot more space to make up.
Well, with just 41 laps completed, it's difficult to determine who exactly has found the right setup. Let's talk to Dr. Jerry Punch about that.
Down in the Dale Earnhardt Jr. pits with crew chief Tony Urie Sr. And Tony, the fact that you guys led lap number two indicates that you're pretty close on your setup. Is Dale Jr. happy with it?
Well, so far he's pretty happy with it. We tried two or three different setups in it yesterday, and we tested here, the setup that we got in the car now, we tested with that, and Dale drove it, and he didn't really like the way the car drove, and so we tried some different stuff when we tested. So when we went into our first practice yesterday morning, we decided we wanted to go back with that package that we had that Dale Jr. liked. So we went with that, and we just kept working. We just never got the car really the way he wanted. So we, after the first hour and a half of practice, while during the Busch race, we put it back like it, Dale Sr. and Steve Park had their car and all, and the first five or six laps Dale Jr. running, he said, man, this thing's awful, let's go back to where we were. So we went back to our original deal we had when we tested, and just kind of tuned on that for during happy hour. So got the car real good. He was a little loose getting in the corner yesterday, but I think this cool weather's tightened it up a little bit. We were scared to put any more tape on it, so the motor's running a little cool, but we didn't know how much tape we could stand because we was a little loose getting in the corner yesterday. So he said the car's good and snug and driving real good right now.
Tony, when he passed Mark Martin at the beginning of the race to take the lead, he said Martin taught him something very, but he's a rookie, of course, only his third race this year in his rookie year. What did Mark teach him about driving early on in a race like this?
Well, he just come on the radio and said them guys were probably a little smarter than he was, that he was over driving the car there a little bit and got it kicking loose off the corner over there. So he backed off there a little bit and followed Mark a little bit, and he says these guys are a little smarter than me, I think. So we're back in the lead now, so we'll have to see what he does when he starts back.
All about a rookie learning how to drive, and certainly he's doing that quickly. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
Well, here in the DeWalt pit, they're all jacked up about the chances of Matt Kenseth. You started lucky 21, Robbie Reiser, and you're up to second. You did it with a two-tire stop.
Yeah, we went with two tires here early. Thought, hey, this is Las Vegas, we'll gamble a little bit here early. I don't know. He says this car's pretty good, so I thought take a chance and just put two tires on it, get some track position, and see how it plays out.
And he ran the 300-mile race here yesterday. That help at all?
That probably didn't help with this decision. It was just that we started back a little ways and just thought, you know, it is early. This would be a chance to look at two tires. Maybe that'd be something we'd want to try later on, so we'll find out early.
So when this thing goes back to green, you'll have an idea how two tires will help or hurt your car.
Well, yeah, we would if we kept running, but now that everything's cooled down, I don't really know how much this is going to, you know, how much of gauge we're going to get here. We'll just have to see how this works out.
Easier to gamble with a young rookie driver?
I don't know. Either that I wasn't real smart and put two tires on or something, but we'll just try and we'll see how it works.
Okay, best of luck to you.
Thanks.
That's Robbie Reiser here in Vegas. Most people stand on 17, and Robbie and his crew hope to be standing on top of 17 in Victory Lane at the end of the day. John?
Sterling Marlin also took on right side tires only. I'm with his crew chief, Scott Eggleston, and he is in third place. Just a track position move there?
Well, we lost all our money in the casino and couldn't afford the tires. Our left sides were looking real good in practice, and we didn't wear them out at all. So we just took a gamble to get a little track position. Knew it was going to be raining a little bit, get a little time to cool the left sides down. So it's car's handling good, so it should be okay.
Has Sterling said anything about it since the red flag has come out? I mean, have you guys been able to talk at all about what you might be doing the rest of the day?
He's just riding around. I told him he's still in third there. And he said that car was handling good there. But he didn't want to. I asked him if he wanted a sandwich or anything, and he was okay. He didn't say anything. He said the car is just driving good, and we're just trying to get a little track position and go from there.
So how much did you guys really lose? Sorry, I didn't mean to put you on the spot there.
No, I didn't lose. I don't know. Some of the guys lost a little, but everybody's about even.
All right, Scott Eggleston, crew chief for Sterling Marlin, currently sitting in the third place after that right side tire change.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., Matt Kenseth are first and second, then Marlin, Jeff Burton fourth, and Mark Martin is in fifth position in this red flag period with 41 laps completed. Well, while we wait out the weather situation here and while the trucks continue to try to dry the track, we're going to take a break and send it back to our ABC Wide World of Sports studio in New York. And here is your host, Robin Roberts. Cars remain covered with their tarps down in the Turn 1 area of Las Vegas Motor Speedway as the race continues to be halted because of some moisture falling over the facility. And we just now hear that the drivers have been ordered to their cars, so that's a good sign. We should be back racing before too much longer. Dale Earnhardt Jr., the leader of the race, begins to move toward his car, and Mark Martin prepares to get in his number 6 Valvoline Ford. So we'll take a break and be back with more, hopefully, green flag racing in just a moment. Well, now the tarps are off the cars. The drivers have been ordered back in them, and in just moments, we should get the command to refire the engines and get this thing back underway. We have been red for a few minutes because of some light rain falling over Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Well, NASCAR is always looking for different ways to improve safety, not only for the drivers and the crew members, but also for fans, and it's no different this year, as we see in this NASCAR 2000 moment. Brought to you by Budweiser. And we go back to the Busch race yesterday here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway on board with Mike McLaughlin.
McLaughlin loses a right rear tire going down in turn one, hits the wall hard, and then the hood flies up on the car, and the hood tether there and there keeps the hood from coming off and possibly flying outside the racetrack. We saw that 3 or 4 years ago. This is NASCAR's solution, and yesterday it seemed to work perfectly in keeping that hood attached to the car.
More to Jerry Punch.
And I am actually holding one of these hood tethers. They're a very simple looking piece of synthetic rope. And let me show you what they do. They basically loop this tether around, and I'm going to act as if my hand is a roll bar underneath the hood.
It goes around the roll bar like that. Then this part of the tether is bolted beneath the bottom part of the hood. So if there is an impact and the hinge breaks, the hood will jerk, but it'll stay in position because of this tether. That's for safety. They have them around the hood and also the suspension parts, the spindles, on the right and left front of the car. So if there's an impact, as we saw yesterday here or in Daytona with Jeffrey Bodine's truck, the spindles and the front suspension parts and the hood will stay attached. Safety first in NASCAR, guys.
All right, thank you, Jerry. And speaking of Jeffrey Bodine, we understand that he is progressing well. We want to say get well, and we hope to see you back at the racetrack soon. Jeffrey, who, of course, was injured in that incredible accident during the NASCAR Craftsman Truck Series event at Daytona. Let's check the Napa field summary once again and show you where they're running. At the conclusion of 41 laps, Dale Earnhardt Jr. has led 23 laps so far. The pole sitter, Ricky Rudd, has fallen to 13th spot. He led just one lap, the opening one. Now here's 16 through 30.
Ward Burton leads that group. Then Dale Earnhardt, Rusty Wallace. Johnny Benson continues his great runs in the year 2000. Terry Labonte, John Andretti has moved up to the 30th spot.
And 31 through 43 shows you that just one car is not on the lead lap. Wally Dallenbach, he was penalized for passing a car before reaching the start-finish line at the very beginning of the race. Don't go away. The command has been given. The engines have been refired, and we'll be back with racing from Las Vegas Motor Speedway in a moment. The cars are rolling once again in the CarsDirect.com 400 here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We'll be back to racing in just a moment. The road to the Visa Triple Crown Challenge on ABC begins Saturday. Get an early look at some of this year's top three-year-olds as they run for victory in the Florida Derby, the 49th running of that event. That's Saturday at 5:30 Eastern and Pacific on ABC, the home of the Kentucky Derby. As we await the drop of the green flag, Bill Weber with the crew chief on the defending series champion in NASCAR Winston Cup, Dale Jarrett.
And that'd be Todd Parrott. First of all, this morning your hood did go up on pit road. What happened there, Todd?
He thought he felt like maybe something was rubbing the steering shaft. We changed motors this morning and, you know, just wanted to check, make sure there wasn't nothing rubbing the steering shaft.
How's the car been so far today?
Just a little bit tight. You know, we got the car really good yesterday afternoon, happy hour, and, you know, we're probably going to pay a little bit of a price until we get some air pressure, some wedge adjusted, but I think all this stuff passes over, racetrack gets slick, we're going to be pretty good.
And you'll stay out for now?
Yeah, we're going to stay out right now.
Okay, and you've got some guests here with you, huh?
Yeah, we got a couple friends from Thursday, the guys that flew me and Robert on the F-16, Captain Craig Baker and my man Max Bluto. These guys, the deal pre-race show, the F-16's going over. I can't put into words the feeling that it is to actually get to fly one of those things. I actually flew an F-16 for 25 minutes on Thursday. Most incredible thing I've ever done. So these guys, my hat's off to them.
I knew you could do it.
Yeah, it's an awesome feeling, and I didn't get sick either. A couple other guys with me got sick.
Hey, good luck this afternoon.
Thank you very much.
And, of course, the Air Force Base is right across the street, and Captain Craig Baker in the red jacket and Captain Jack Maxner in the blue jacket took Robert Yates and Todd Parrott for quite a ride here earlier this week, and they enjoyed every minute, well, almost every minute of it.
Sounds like Bill may be bucking for a ride in one of those, doesn't it?
Sounds to me like it.
I wouldn't do that for anything. Well, pit road is open, and some are taking advantage of it.
See Bobby Hamilton, the first car down. Scott Pruitt, once again, is coming down pit road. And I know that, ever see Scott Pruitt in the Tide ride coming down pit road, I know that he and the crew, Doug Richard and the crew, have had long conversations during this red flag, and they've decided whatever changes they're going to make need to be made now. Bobby Hamilton, Kodak Film. Chevrolet's in pits, changes four times. Bill Weber?
Well, for Todd, or for Scott Pruitt, rather, it was just fuel, so obviously the track position not a factor for these guys. They wanted to come in and top off. That way they might have a little bit advantage if this thing stays green for a long period of time.
Derek Cope, Stacy Compton, also on pit road, the 75 of Wally Dallenbach, and Bobby Hamilton also coming off of pit road. Now, these laps under caution here are counting, so 43 have now been completed as Bobby Hamilton stays under that 45-mile-an-hour speed limit down pit road. When he reaches the final yellow mark, he can accelerate on the warm-up lane there to the inside of the actual racetrack. Well, the pace car leads the field out of corner number four here, and when they hit the line, they will be given the one-to-go signal, and the red flag time amounted to just 20 minutes.
We'll probably get to see right now whether or not the two-tire stop is going to work for some of these guys. The bad thing for the guys that took two tires, when you have hot tires on a car and they cool back down, they go through a heat cycle, sometimes they don't act the same. So two tires might have been a good idea if they could have kept running, but now the tires had a chance to cool off. It might hurt those guys.
So if the car isn't right, they don't know if it was the two tires or the fact that the left side's had a chance to cool.
Yeah, Benny, they really won't know now whether or not two tires is a good idea, being that the left sides have gone through a heat cycle against brand new right sides.
Robbie Gordon is making a late pit stop, as is Darrell Waltrip, while that is Michael Waltrip, the first car behind the pace car, and Michael is on the tail end of the lead lap in 42nd position. The leader of the race is the second car, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Now, five drivers, the top five finishers in last month's Daytona 500, are eligible for a $1 million Noble 5 bonus if they can win here today. Jeff Burton currently running fourth, Mark Martin is fifth, Elliott sixth, Jarrett seventh, and Rusty Wallace in 18th, as we get set to go back to competition. And don't forget, five fans have been paired with each of those drivers and will also win $1 million if their driver is successful.
Michael Waltrip, the seven car, as you said, is a lap down. He had an unscheduled pit stop under the green flag to change four tires, had a vibration, and that's what put the seven car a lap down. Hill comes off the corner, anticipating the green flag.
And they get it. Here we go.
In the 75, Waltrip in the 7, both those cars are on the tail end of the lead lap now.
And of course, both want to try desperately to stay ahead of Dale Earnhardt Jr. or whoever is leading the race, so that we do have another caution. They can make up a mile and a half. Good action in the back of the pack here. Here is Rudd running alongside Ricky Craven through the first corner. That's the battle for the 12th position.
77 car, Robert Presley right behind Ricky Rudd. Rusty Wallace trying to make a move on the outside. Earnhardt on the inside.
That's the battle for the 17th position. And here comes Elliott Sadler in the 21 car. Coming off the second corner.
Elliott Sadler takes that spot away from Dale Earnhardt. Elliott Sadler did not qualify that well, but thought they had a dynamite race setup. It looks like the car is pretty good so far.
That allows Earnhardt to get to the low side and battle with him for the position and taking the position, and now Johnny Benson may try to do likewise.
The green number 42 is Kenny Irwin.
Benson, who came into the season without a sponsor on that car, had such a great run at the Daytona 500. In fact, was leading with just a few laps to go. They secured Lycos.com as a sponsor on that number 10 car. There's Terry Labonte running behind Kenny Irwin. Jimmy Spencer is back in this group of cars. But up front, there is a battle for second as Jeff Burton now comes up to make a challenge on the 17 of Matt Kenseth.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., as you saw, the Bud car has been able to get by
Darrell Waltrip as Mark Martin trying to get up and take the spot away from Sterling Marlin. A battle for the fourth
back
position.
Inside.
Keith Simmons, a spotter for Sterling Marlin, telling the car was on the inside. And both of those cars that were trying to stay on the lead lap, namely Wally Dahlenbach and Michael Waltrip, have been passed by Dale Earnhardt Jr., and so they are a lap down. Mark Martin in fourth spot.
Bobby Labonte, Dale Jarrett, and Tony Stewart.
Ooh. Three wide down the front straightaway. That's the great thing about a wide, smooth racetrack. You can do things like that and get away with it. As Tony Stewart trying his best to get by Dale Jarrett. Jeremy Mayfield back there watching things in the mobile car. Once again, Jeff Burton trying to take over the second position from Matt Kenseth. Kenseth trying to go up on the outside of Michael Waltrip, and here comes Burton on the inside. Now both go to the high side. It looks like they're going to be able to get by Michael Walter, but at least Kenseth will, entering the corner, and now Burton does in the corner. Matt continues to hold off the challenge there for the second spot.
We've been under green here for six, seven laps, so it looks like the guys that made the two tire stops really made good decisions. Their cars are actually pretty fast. Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s run some pretty fast laps here since we've gone back to green.
In the back, there is the battle continuing between Dale Earnhardt and Rusty Wallace. And here comes Mark Martin. That six Valvoline car closes right on the back bumper of Jeff Burton. And these drivers running in third and fourth position are the only winners here at Las Vegas. Mark Martin won the inaugural running 2 years ago, and Burton won last year. So Jack Roush is the only car owner to ever enter victory lane for a NASCAR Winston Cup race here at Las Vegas. And it looks like Jeff Burton will make the challenge now on Kenseth for second and take the spot at the end of the backstretch.
Looks like those guys share notes pretty good as a race team, too.
Yes.
Martin goes to the inside and tries to put Matt back to fourth position. Kenseth has run three Busch races here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, but this is his first NASCAR Winston Cup race. And Kenseth continues to lead the points in the Busch series. However, of course, he is not going to run every race in that series and therefore will not be a contender for the championship. But in the first three races, he's run very, very well. Here's a Napa field summary. How about that for a points battle, huh? All three manufacturers are tied at the moment.
Jeff Burton is the leading Ford in second position. The Chevrolet first Chevrolet is Earnhardt Jr. leading the race, and the first Pontiac is sixth, and that's Bobby Labonte, the winner last week at Rockingham.
Just 1 point separating Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Matt Kenseth coming into this race, and there are a couple of rookie contenders who were unable to qualify for this event.
Bill Elliott going down in the corner, turn one. Have to see that Bobby Labonte trying to get by Sterling Marlin. Bill Elliott has gotten a McDonald's Ford by and taken over that spot. This is a battle for six.
He won last week at Rockingham. And his second in the point standings. Got that car right on that white line through the corner. And that allows him to get a good enough run that he takes over the sixth position from Sterling Marlin. Well, not quite yet. Teammates running nose to tail here. Bobby Labonte in 18 and Tony Stewart in the orange number 20 car. And again, Labonte tries to get to the inside of Sterling, but Sterling's car is doing well up there in that middle groove.
And a battle for the lead as it goes up by the start finish line. Earnhardt Jr. will lead that lap, but here comes Jeff Burton down in one. I think he's going to take it, and he does.
So if he leads coming around to the line, he will be the sixth leader we have had so far today in the first 59 laps. Dale Earnhardt Jr. has led the most, 41. Mark Martin has led 9. Kyle Petty has led 6. We'll be back after these messages and a word from our ABC station.
You're watching the CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
There are the first three in the CarsDirect.com 400 here at Las Vegas. That is Jeff Burton, followed by Dale Earnhardt Jr. and Mark Martin running in the third spot.
Well, the two Jack Ross cars have been in the class in the field for the last 2 years, but I'm really impressed with the job Earnhardt Jr. is doing.
And how about Bill Elliott, who is up to fourth position? Our Super 8 serial scoring will show you that he started back in 39th position and is all the way up to fourth, although some of those positions were gained in a pit stop.
Exactly. He was running 25th when he made that pit stop, only changed two tires and jumped from 25th all the way up to sixth spot, but obviously has a good race car, so he's able to stay there.
Spoke to those guys yesterday afternoon, and they didn't understand why the car didn't qualify better. When they untaped it, it ran the same speed, so they knew they had a good race car, just didn't qualify good.
This is a brand new race car. It had never been on a racetrack until Friday's practice session prior to qualifying. So it is performing well here, at least in the first 66 laps of this race.
It's really good to see in the year 2000 Bill Elliott back up front, where last year he was really absent. But Daytona finished third, has a chance today to win the Winston Noble $1 million bonus. And it's really a good thing to see.
And, of course, he won one of the twin 125s at Daytona also, although it was a non-point-paying race. It was his first victory in Winston Cup since September of 1994.
They've got some new guys over there, and the communication and confidence is up. Mike Ford and Barry Swift won a championship last year with Dale Jarrett's crew, and there's a lot of confidence over there on that race team.
You also got to be impressed with the run that Ricky Craven has given that number 50 car, as he is just outside the top 10, running in 11th position and battling alongside Jeremy Mayfield, Sterling Marlin, Johnny Benson.
There's a real fight, a battle right there. And yeah. Craven now is starting to lose some spots. He's been making some ground up on the outside, but now it looks like that he's starting to slow down, or these guys, I guess he's slowing down. And these guys are catching him now on the bottom of the racetrack.
Looked a little loose there, Benny. It might be a sign. I believe Ricky was one of the cars that took two tires, so we'll have to watch and see if those left sides might be going away on those guys.
We're on board with Rusty Wallace. Currently finds himself in the 15th position for a taste of the race. Here's more Jimmy Dean telemetry.
Rusty Wallace will touch that brake going down in the corner. Now he lifts his foot back off, back on the accelerator. We watch as this thing just, the RPMs climbs down the RPM. On the camera, we saw a drop of rain every now and then. Just every now and then we get a drop.
That's the way it's been all day. It has not rained hard ever, but it's a couple of times rained enough to just make things difficult to race under.
Rusty's car actually looked like it was a little bit tight. Did you see how far it came up off the white line in the center of the corner there?
And Rudd is trying to...
Right there in the center of the corner, the nose actually goes up towards the wall.
Rudd's trying to take advantage of it, but cannot do it. So Rudd remains back in the 16th spot.
And we talked about Bill Elliott and the two tires, and Ray Evernham made a comment how good he felt like the car was in race trim. The last lap, Bill Elliott, and this lap as well, Bill Elliott had the fastest lap of the top six cars.
The leader of the race, Jeff Burton, ran a 158.219 last lap, and Elliott had a 159.7. So it was significantly faster, mile and a half an hour faster.
And something happened to Mark Martin last time because he only ran 156, so he evidently got picked up a push or a loose condition, had to back off the throttle. Here comes Bill off the corner. Car's really looking good.
He is one of the drivers eligible for the Noble $5 million bonus. And it's his first attempt at winning the $1 million bonus since he won the million back in 1985. It wasn't the Noble 5 program then. It was the Winston Million, and he won the very first year that that was up for grabs. And we can see, again, more raindrops on the camera lens as Elliott comes through turns 3 and 4. And once again, last lap was the quickest car on the racetrack. That's the leaders that we see direct in front of him. And once again, Bill Elliott, quicker than the top three cars as he closes in, gets closer and closer to those three cars. He's running about 2.3 seconds behind the leader. Our nation's red on-track interval will show you that Elliott has reduced the interval between himself and the leader, Jeff Burton. On lap 68, it was 3.5 seconds. Now it's 2.5.
And you see, Ray, isn't that great to see just those consistent speeds each and every lap and consistently faster than the leader?
Yeah, when you're that consistent, that means the car is very comfortable, and it's very comfortable like that. You can make up a lot of ground.
Starting to rain pretty good here, friend.
Yeah, we can see it as we follow the cars around the racetrack with the camera. We can see the rain hitting the lens of the camera. We saw on board the Super 8 onboard camera from Elliott, some raindrops. Here is the battle for second, and Mark Martin takes second from Dale Earnhardt Jr. So now the Jack Roush cars and the two previous winners here at the Speedway are running in first and second positions.
Bill Elliott now just 1.9 seconds behind the leader.
And closing in on the back of the 8 car, Dale Earnhardt Jr. Here's another Napa field summary showing you the points right now. Bobby Labonte has taken over the points lead from Dale Jarrett, and Mark Martin has moved to second position.
Bobby Labonte is running fifth, and Jarrett is running eighth. Just goes to show you how close the point standings are just two races into the season.
Scott Pruitt has been lapped. The driver who started on the outside of the front row, the rookie contender, has gone a lap down here on the 77th circuit. And now he, along with Michael Waltrip and Wally Dallenbach, are the three cars not on the lead lap. And also Mark Martin is able to pass by Scott Pruitt. And look now at Bill Elliott, who has caught Dale Earnhardt Jr. This is the battle for third. And into the first corner, Elliott goes to third.
Wow. Impressive run today for Elliott. Impressive season for Elliott.
And he just stands on the accelerator and drives away from Little E. And Jerry has more on Earnhardt Jr.
They have not made a single adjustment on the Budweiser Chevrolet at all today, but now they will have to on their next stop, probably coming up for the next 15 laps or so. Earnhardt Jr. complaining that the car is tight from the middle of the corner off. He cannot get the car to turn. He's having to back out a little bit of the throttle, and thus passed pretty easily a moment ago by Bill Elliott.
Right, the raindrop we're seeing on the lens of these onboard cameras, it looks like a great deal, but at 170 miles per hour, it doesn't take a lot of rain to look like a great deal, does it?
No, Benny, it doesn't. And as long as the cars keep circulating around the racetrack, they're probably keeping the racing groove pretty dry. It's really unnerving to a driver to see raindrops hitting the windshield, but sometimes that moisture just doesn't get on the racetrack.
And we have Elliott Sadler on pit road. Jerry Punch is right there.
And at 45 miles per hour, scheduled pit stop for Elliott Sadler, sophomore season driver. Citgo crew going over. They will change four tires. On his previous pit stop, he was complaining the car was tight in the center, but loose coming up the corner. They had made a wedge and an air pressure adjustment. Thus far, no wedge change here, just air pressure only for Elliott Sadler. Left side tires only, get it full of fuel. He says the car will not turn. That's why they made the air pressure adjustment. The car is still a little bit tight as he exits pit road.
We talked about a moment ago Bill Elliott and how he's closer and closer. Hey, he was the fastest car on the racetrack. Well, Martin looked up in the mirror and saw that, or someone told him that, because he has really picked up the pace. We see Mark up there as he closes in right on the back bumper of Jeff Burton. As he looks back from Mark Martin, as he looks back at Bill Elliott. Now, Mark Martin, the last couple laps, has been running over 160 miles per hour.
And the interval between second and third is about 1.1 seconds, and you can see the interval between first and second, not that much, just a matter of car lengths, as Jeff Burton has the advantage right now over Mark Martin with 81 of 267 laps completed. Bill Elliott, Dale Earnhardt Jr., and Bobby Labonte, the top five. When you come to Las Vegas, you think about, well, a lot of things, but especially winning and losing a lot of money. And today, five drivers can win a lot of money. The five drivers who finished 1 through 5 at Daytona, Jared Burton, Elliott, Wallace, and Mark Martin will win the noble $5 million bonus if they can win here today. And currently, three of them are running in the top three, with Jared back in eighth and Wallace in 15th.
Bill Elliott back in third spot. We see Mark Martin up in front. Jeff Fuller now has gone a lap down. There's Dale Jarrett, the Ford Quality Care, running back in the eighth position. And Rusty Wallace, the Miller Lite Ford, is back in 15th. That's their Noble 5 contenders at the battle for the fourth position.
And Tony Stewart will go to the inside of Dale Earnhardt Jr. and take over the fourth spot. We have six cars that are not on the lead lap now. Jeff Fuller, also Derek Cope, has lost a lap, in addition to Michael Waltrip, Wally Dallenbach, Scott Pruitt, and Elliott Sadler, who made a pit stop a little bit ago. On board with Bobby Labonte as he, too, tries to gain a position on Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Both those cars have been able to get by the 17 of Matt Kenseth. It looks like that those cars that stopped and only changed two tires on their only caution flag for the rain, it looks like that two-tire change is really starting to affect the cars.
It really does, Benny. The only guy that's messing that up for us is Bill Elliott.
Yep.
He's still going pretty good on two tires. The other guys, left sides, might just be giving up just a little bit.
You see the adjuster for the right rear on Earnhardt Jr.'s car.
And here comes Matt Kenseth to challenge Dale Earnhardt Jr. And if successful, that would move him up into sixth spot. And it is successful. Now we're on board with Dale Jarrett, who also is trying to pass Little E, who's caught on the outside of the racetrack.
Now, the 17 car was one of those cars that took two tires also, Benny. What we might be seeing here is the fact that we've been under green for quite some time. There's getting rubber down on the racetrack, and the racetrack is changing a little bit.
During our commercial, there we see Dale Earnhardt in the 3, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8, and father goes by son, moves into the 8th position.
And Bill Elliott is on pit road. John Kernan.
And Bill Elliott pulls in for a scheduled service. Very happy with the car. This is a brand new car that had never been on the racetrack until Friday. They're already done with the right side. Swing around to the left side. They have not made any chassis adjustments, nor do we anticipate any. Left's going on, tightening up the lug nuts. They've got a full of fuel, and Bill Elliott is down and away. A good pit stop.
And I tell you what, if the Jackman had not missed a stop on the left side the first time, that would have been a fantastic pit stop. Not bad at 16.9.
Really is, and that's a fairly new crew, too. Eddie DeHunt and those guys have been working real hard on their pit stop.
All right, back out on the racetrack. Now Kenny Wallace goes a lap down in 36th position as Jeff Burton is able to pass him.
We had something very strange happen during our last commercial break. Mark Martin, who was right on the back bumper of Jeff Burton, all of a sudden lost distance and slowed down about 5.
Oh,
and we see Steve
Park. Of smoke coming from the number one Pennzoil Chevy.
The car appears to be running. I mean, it doesn't look like a blown engine. It looks like an oil line or something.
Boy, a great run for Steve Park last weekend at Rockingham, coming home in 9th position. But some smoke has caused the car to come to pit road, and now the crew will begin to try to ascertain what happened. And Rusty Wallace also makes a visit to pit road.
Rusty Wallace has some new members on his crew this year, and they've really been struggling. Jeremy Mayfield coming down pit road. When I say struggling, they've been making 17, 18-second pit stops when you've got to make them in 15, 16.
right side. Whoa, that was quick. Earl Barbin takes that jack, starts around to the left side. Car goes up. Having trouble on the left and the rear. Once again, always just something is happening on Russ. That was Jeremy's pit stop. And that was his teammate, Jeremy Mayfield. He's away. These pit stops occurring on the 95th lap of the race. And Ricky Rudd, the pole sitter, is on pit road now. And to Bill Weber.
Ricky Rudd's car has been fairly good since the green flag came out. This is a routine stop for tires and fuel. Rudd was the pole sitter, looking for his first win since Martinsville on that hot day in the summer of 98. Meanwhile, just past him, the race leader, Jeff Burton, now on pit road. Burton wants a pound out of the right front tire. He also wants to make a change he talked about yesterday in the Busch race. He wanted to write it down in the Busch race. He didn't want to discuss it on the radio. He told his crew in this race he wanted to make the same change he made yesterday. Another good stop for the 99 car. He's on his way out the pit road.
Very good stop, Bill. 16.1 seconds for Jeff, and he is rolling once again. So is Dale Jarrett.
And so is Dale Earnhardt, as Earnhardt goes by Jarrett off pit road to take that spot away.
Also coming out are Joe Nemechek. And Dale Earnhardt Jr. now comes in.
Down pit road. Yep. He's the very first pit.
And Jerry Punch is right there.
Earnhardt Jr., 25 years of age, defending Busch Series champion, only his eighth ever Winston Cup start. Remember, he was complaining the car was tight from the middle of the corner off. They made an air pressure adjustment to try to free the car up a little bit, or actually keep the car from being so tight coming off. Left side tire zone, routine pit stop for Jr., he is down and away. The tire rolls away across pit road.
That tire loose down there.
Of that the first two races this year.
Sterling Marlin's spotter Keith Simmons that was talking about the tires. We'll see Jerry Nadeau come down pit road. Is Robbie Gordon now in the 13 car is the leader of the race.
He is off sequence as far as pit stops are concerned. He made one not too long ago and so picks up the lead of the race. Bobby Labonte is just ahead of him. There are the standings. Kenny Irwin, Ted Musgrave, Kyle Petty, and Jeff Gordon now make up the top five here at Las Vegas. Robbie Gordon, who was the leader, now comes in. And look, he has to stand on the brakes. You've got to be below 45 miles an hour right there at that second white line. And he had to stand on the brakes to achieve that. Bill Weber, he's headed toward you.
And Bob, they'd asked him to stay out six or seven more laps, but the traffic and the new tires were just killing him. So they tried to get him in the lap before this one. He couldn't make it onto pit road. Actually wasn't clear on the communication. Now he does slide to a stop in his pit stall. This is a routine stop. They will clean the grill, pull the plastic cover off the windshield so he has clearer vision, four tires and a full tank of fuel around to the left side. Slides underneath, lost his balance there, lost his footing. That cost him some precious seconds. Now the left side tires are off, so this stop will be a little lengthy.
20.8 second pit stop. He goes a lap down, and now that puts Jeff Burton back in the lead here as everybody has made a pit stop in the last few laps. Gordon accelerates off of the warm-up lane, and now the number four car of Bobby Hamilton comes in near John Kernan.
Hamilton pulls in. It'll be a four-tire change. They're also trying to bump up the spoiler just a little bit, and we also will see a chassis adjustment. They're going to take a little wedge out of the car by making the adjustment on the left rear. They're swinging around to the left side, putting it on. They still, now, the tire carrier reaches up, makes that half round out of the wedge, and Hamilton is down and away.
16.9 second pit stop for Bobby Hamilton and crew.
Coming slowly down pit road, 45 miles per hour. Here's the speed limit on pit road. Battle for second spot as Mark Martin has caught Bill Elliott going in three. He takes that spot away.
We saw the big smoke from the number one car of Steve Park. The car has gone to the garage area. Jerry, watch the report.
Bob, it is not good news. They came down pit road, raised the hood, and Paul Andrews said there were dents on the outside of the oil pan where apparently something in the bottom of the engine came apart and went slamming down on the oil pan and produced a number of dents. And the engine basically was locking itself up as he was coming down pit road. Steve Park climbed out of the car, very, very frustrated, slammed his fist on the roof of the car and walked away. Very upset. He hoped to be able to get another top 10 finish here like he did last week in Rockingham.
And he had moved into the top 20 in points also, so a big disappointment for Steve Park. Overhead shots today are courtesy of the Pennzoil copter cam. Not a great deal of ceiling because of the cloud cover that we have, but nevertheless, the Pennzoil copter cam up there providing the overhead shots. And we're watching second and third place, Mark Martin and Bill Elliott. Up ahead by just about a second is the 99 car of Jeff Burton, the leader of the race with 107 of 267 laps completed. A little bit of a problem as we saw on the 13 car when it made the pit stop. Bill, watch the report there.
35 pounds. Well, Robbie Gordon back on the racetrack. We mentioned that he had a very long pit stop, and one of the reasons why they had a problem with the jack. When they came around at one point, these jacks are on wheels, and at one point, the wheel came off the jack. Watch the jack man slip. They still were able to raise the car, but it cost them precious seconds on the pit stop. And now they have a backup jack. Robbie Gordon comes down pit road.
And he does stay on the lead lap, running in 23rd position at the moment. And now we see Mark Martin closing in on Jeff Burton. And just ahead of Jeff Burton is Ward Burton, his brother. Those two battled to the checkered flag last year here at Las Vegas. But things not going so well for Ward today, as he is the last car on the lead lap in 22nd spot.
And this battle has been going on for the last few laps, as Ward and that Caterpillar car desperately trying to stay on the lead lap and hoping that his brother will cut in some slack and let him stay up there. But meanwhile, while he's been holding his brother up, Mark Martin and Bill Elliott has closed in right on the back bumper.
Good three-car battle here in traffic. Burton, Mark Martin, and Bill Elliott, who is third, having come from a 39th and provisional starting spot. That's Jimmy Spencer just ahead of Bill Elliott, between Elliott and Martin, and he is a lap down in 27.
And that battle still goes on between the Burton brothers. Ward just desperately trying to stay on the lead lap, trying to take that line away. Right now, Jeff Burton needs to let his car drift out against the wall because Ward is there, and that's slowing him down just a little bit, enough that Mark Martin has gone by and taken the lead.
Update you on the Noble 5 contenders up in the left-hand corner of the screen. Ward Burton coming off a third-place finish at Rockingham last week after an eighth-place finish at Daytona. And as I said, he finished in second position to his brother here at Vegas last year.
Now, Mark Martin, Ward doesn't expect the same courtesy from Mark that he got from his brother, but Mark is a very courteous driver, and once again, he's taking that line away, and Burton now tries to look under Mark Martin.
He's making those guys run underneath of them and abuse their tires, tire pressure, wear their tires out, and they just got to probably settle down and let it cool off. But Ward's doing everything he can to stay on the lead lap.
What happens now if the caution flag should come out? The leader right now, Mark Martin, would slow down. The pace car would pick up Mark Martin, and the 22 Ward Burton able to go all the way around the racetrack and make up essentially a mile and a half. Oh, got him a little loose.
Oh, yeah.
But he pulled up right behind that 22 car that takes air off that rear spoiler. We saw that 22 wiggle as he came off the corner.
But still, Martin is unable to get the position or lap Ward Burton. Ward is hanging tough. Here's some more Taste of the Race telemetry from Jimmy Dean Sausages. And up to 187 miles an hour, and then about a little over half braking.
And Ward Burton still stays in front of these two cars.
Actually, looks like Mark's car's a little bit loose underneath the 22.
You can put the number one car of Steve Park officially out of the race. So Park is going to finish in last position here this week. Check out some Super 8 serial scoring on Mark Martin, who started in the fifth spot, dropped back to seventh at the end of 22 laps, and then has progressed from that point up to the lead here with 114 laps completed.
You know, one car behind another car is not the only way to take air off a spoiler. Sometimes two cars are side by side, the inside car loses the air off its spoiler.
Check out the telemetry here from Jeff Burton.
And that time, Mark got a terrific run off turn four. Looked like Ward got looser, started pushing off the corner. And when he lost his momentum, Mark just drove by. Now, I think Ward will just simply let his... never mind.
Not so easy. He just stayed right in the throttle there, trying to get by his brother. And now he will. 25 cars now on the lead lap as Ward Burton goes a lap down. Mark Martin is the only driver in NASCAR Winston Cup competition to lead all three races so far this year. He has led, as a matter of fact, in the last six events going back to the final races of 1999. Well, a lot of people are asking for more money so they can hit the casinos tonight here in Las Vegas, including the Ken Schrader crew. There are the top 10 with 117 laps completed. We'll be right back.
The CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC Sports, brought to you by Exide NASCAR Select, the official automotive battery of NASCAR. For construction rental equipment, nation's rent, no sweat. And Team Monte Carlo.
Welcome back to ABC's live coverage of the CarsDirect.com 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race from Las Vegas Motor Speedway. I'm Bob Jenkins, along with Benny Parsons, Ray Evernham, John Kernan, Bill Weber, and Dr. Jerry Punch reporting from pit road. It's a 267-lap race. We've completed 123. And right now, after a rain delay of 20 minutes, we see that Mark Martin is the leader. In our Napa field summary, Jeff Burton is running in second position, the defending champion of the race. Tony Stewart, last year's Rivestas Rookie of the Year, runs third. Bill Elliott, up from a back-of-the-field starting position, runs fourth. Last week's winner, Bobby Labonte, runs in fifth position. Dale Earnhardt is in sixth, followed by the Daytona 500 winner, Dale Jarrett. Here's 16 through 30, and there are currently 24 cars on the lead lap. And the remainder of the field will show you that there's just one car out of the race. That is Steve Park, who retired just a few moments ago. On the racetrack, there are first and second as they continue to lap cars. That's Jeff Fuller in the Viagra Pontiac that's being lapped. But look at Tony Stewart, who has closed in on the second place car of Jeff Burton. Stewart is in the orange Home Depot Pontiac.
And remember how well that Tony Stewart, Bobby Labonte ran at Homestead last fall, second to the last race of the year. And I would think that Las Vegas Homestead, the setup would be fairly close.
Both tracks are flat, fast, large corners, and Tony ran extremely well on the flat tracks. Talked to Greg Zipidelli yesterday, and Greg said the car was so good he was a little bit scared. You're always scared because you think something's going to happen when you have a good car, Ben.
Tony Stewart started 7th, finished 17th in Daytona 500. He started 15th and finished 4th at the Rockingham facility last week. He started 16th here today and is currently in the 3rd position.
See Johnny Benson going by. He's currently in the 8th position.
But he's having a good run, Benson is.
Wow, Scott Pruitt looks like something's definitely wrong with the tire ride as Benson just blew by him. Off turn two, and watch as Benson closes in right on the back bumper of Terry Labonte in that Kellogg Chevrolet. Labonte is a lap down back in 31st.
Johnny Benson started in eighth and is currently running in the eighth position.
And right in front of him, a good battle going on for the sixth spot between the 88 and the 3. Earnhardt has it. Jarrett wants it, and Jarrett looks like he's going to take it away. He does.
Sixth position goes to Jarrett. A little bit of a wiggle there coming off the corner. Five bonus points are paid to a driver if he leads a lap, and five additional bonus points are paid to the driver who leads the most laps. Right now, Jeff Burton has led the most laps at 43, but Dale Earnhardt Jr., only one behind, having led 42 laps. Mark Martin has been in front for 26 circuits. Robbie Gordon led 8. Kyle Petty led 6 laps. Darrell Waltrip led 2. And the pole sitter, Ricky Rudd, was out front for just 1 lap, the opening lap. And he currently finds himself back in the 12th position. Dale Jarrett currently running in the 6th spot.
And look at Tony Stewart at Home Depot Pontiac. Gets closed up right on the back bumper of Jeff Burton. And that score monitor we have is showing us that the last few laps, Tony Stewart has been faster than both Burton and Mark Martin.
That green car up ahead is Kenny Irwin Jr. Jerry has more.
You guys were speculating about Tony Stewart's race car. It is their flat track race car. They have one that Tony absolutely loves. This car finished 6th at Indianapolis last year, 4th at Pocono, 2nd at Loudon, and yes, this is the car that he won with at Homestead in the next to last race of 1999.
Here's Johnny Benson. He just passed Dale Earnhardt and now comes up to put a challenge on Dale Jarrett. Benson is like a driver with new life so far in the third race of this year in 3 races.
He and Bill Elliott this year have been, you know, just seem to be head and shoulders above last year. You know, Benson last year bought himself out of a contract with Jack Roush so he could become a free agent and look around, and he chose the Tinker, an unsponsored car of Tim Beverly, and you wondered, was that very wise? But he went to Daytona, almost won the Daytona 500, picked up a sponsor, and it looks like that was a very wise decision.
Benson, however, did establish his best career finish at this facility in 1998, finishing in 4th position. He finished 28th in the point standings last year with the Jack Roush team, and with the new team this year has renewed life. Here is Dale Jarrett now coming up on Kyle Petty, and Jerry Punch has more.
You know, Johnny Benson was very quick to give credit to his young crew chief. His crew chief, James Ince, is the youngest crew chief in Winston Cup racing. He's been a crew chief for 4 years. He was a Winston Cup crew chief at the age of 24 and a half. He just turned 29. And also, by the way, that team this year has Hendrick Horsepower. And that says a lot about right there about how well they're running. Hendrick Horsepower, a young crew chief who communicates well with a very hungry race driver.
Both finishes this year for Johnny Benson have been in the top 15. He finished 12th at Daytona, 14th at Rockingham. This was his best start of the year in 8th position. We have reached the halfway point.
This time by, Jeff Burton looks like he thinks that Gatorade pays $10,000 for the halfway point. That's not the case. They pay for the driver that leads the most laps this year. And you saw that time how much faster that Jeff Burton was than Mark Martin. I think that was probably because Mark has been catching and passing some traffic.
Having to deal with the 77 car now, Robert Presley, who's in 21st position. There is Tony Stewart, who is just a couple of car lengths behind second place Jeff Burton.
Pass a car here and they take that line away. It really slows down your efforts. We saw Tony Stewart with no traffic just move in right on the back of these front two. And here comes Burton. This is for the lead. The Conseco on board shows Burton going by.
Jeff Burton at the end of the back stretch takes over the top spot from Mark Martin once again. Lead changes, of course, are only measured at the start-finish line. There is the start-finish line, so Jeff Burton leads the 136th lap. Now we'll see what Tony Stewart can do with second place Mark Martin. Look at him come up. Whoa, all the way on the apron.
Wow. I think Mark had some kind of, I think he had to get off the gas because of trying to lap Elliott Sadler's car. But now we see the 77 car of Robert Presley driving up on the inside.
Sometimes if you got to get out of gas for any reason, it takes a couple laps to get the momentum built back up with the gear in these cars. And for some reason, with Tony behind Mark, he had to lift a little bit loose maybe.
Presley was lapped just a few minutes ago. Mark having a difficult time getting around him. Well, it's Jeff Burton, Tony Stewart, Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, and Bobby Labonte, the top five here at the CarsDirect.com 400. Jeff Burton in the number 99. Exide Ford continues to lead the CarsDirect.com 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. 142 laps have been completed. And there are, as you might be able to see occasionally, four raindrops falling.
It does appear like the mist or sprinkles that we've had on and off all day are starting to increase here at the Las Vegas Motor Speedway. And Tony Stewart is closing right in that last lap. Burton is trying to get by the four car around 156. Tony Stewart over 158, but now Stewart has the same problem. He's got to try to get by Bobby Hamilton.
And gets to the inside of him in the third corner, and now he has no cars between himself and Burton.
And the caution flag does come out.
Caution now. Come on around. Get back here.
It's been rain, Bill Weber.
Rain in turn two is what they're saying now, and rain is a great concern. Several of these teams just checked the radar. They're concerned the next time the rain gets here, that will be it. So what you might have to be concerned about now is if you pit, there's a possibility this race may not go back to green. That's only a possibility at this point, but it is figuring into pit strategy right now.
Boy, Ray, this is a situation that you've been in many times.
And I'll tell you what, this is the first time I'm happy I'm sitting up here instead of down there, because I would not want to be Frankie Stoddard right now. He's got to make a decision. Does he pit? Is the rain going to stay? We're past halfway. This is a million-dollar decision he's got to make. Frankie's going to earn his money today. I'm glad I'm up here.
We have seen Jeff Burton win a million-dollar bonus in the rain. What would you do, Ray?
I would have... We'd have a guy stationed down at the NASCAR trailer looking at the weather, and I'd just have to make a call. Based on what we've seen today, I'd probably bring him in. But then again, looking at what I can see from up here that he can't see, I might leave him out.
But that's straddling the fence now. Come on, man. What would you do?
Well, I'll tell you what. Even though it's Vegas, I don't know if I'd be willing to bet $1 million.
Jerry, what are they saying down there?
Ray, I think they agree with you. They have looked at the radar as well, and it's really a roll of the dice. There's a front moving in that's beginning to break up somewhat, but there's a lot of rain around that front, and so Frankie is talking to his driver. Jeff Burton said, you help me make the call, and from what I hear him saying on the radio, they're probably going to stay out right now, stay on the racetrack, and maybe figure the rain will move in, and they might win this thing along with a million-dollar bonus.
All right, let's see. They're coming into the entrance to pit road. That's it's time, Ray.
Well, the only thing he can do is watch his mirror if they start to come, and maybe everybody will stay out with the leader. Here comes Tony Stewart. He's like, oh, no!
A fake job.
No one is coming down pit road, because I'm sure they've all been down to that radar decision. Looking at that radar and deciding that the rain may be here.
Now, what do you think, Ray? Had his crew decided to bring him in and then change their mind, or was Tony just faking him out?
Tony was probably trying to get the rest of the cars to come with him and hang Jeff Burton out there, but Frankie Stoddard just breathed the biggest sigh of relief I'm sure he ever breathed in his whole life. So they made a good call. Everybody did stay out with him.
Look at Frankie. What do I do? Come on, man. Help me out.
He's got a few more gray hairs.
He said, rain. Either rain or quit rain. One or the other. Don't do this to me.
And it is just a little bit more than a mist. We do have a couple of cars that have come in for pit stops. Jeremy Mayfield is on pit row, Jerry.
With a very good race car here, they went ahead and made the call to come in and change four tires. They're going to roll the dice here at Vegas, and why not? I mean, they're not going to win if they stay out. They come in and pit, and everyone else eventually has to pit because they get to go back to green flag racing. They'll be the leaders up at the front of the field. Four tires, Mayfield down and away.
And in addition to Jeremy, Chad Little made a pit stop, so did Sterling Marlin, and the 55 car of Kenny Wallace.
That was a gutsy gut. I mean, that's a tough decision to make because Jeff Burton is eligible for the Noble $1 million bonus. If he wins this race, if it does rain and we can't restart this race, that's a $1 million bonus. Jerry, what's going on in Jackie Starter's mind right now?
Frank, gutsy call to stay out. I mean, you were thinking about coming in and opting to stay out. You think the weather's here to stay?
Well, our weather forecast that we've got down there is looking at it. He's saying it's here to stay, but, you know, I don't know what NASCAR is going to do. It's got lights, but I look up there in the stands, you know, and feeling for the fans and stuff, as cold as it is down here, I'd like to see them guys go home and end it right now.
As far as you're concerned, it's raining heavily right now. It may snow any moment, right?
Well, it's certainly the racetrack is black. I mean, the pit road's real wet. Safety-wise, Jeff said the back straightaway is real wet. You know, but the XI car has been good all day. It's not like this thing would be because of rain that we have a chance at this thing. We've got a good car. He's drove a great race. But hats off to the pit crew. They've done a great job all day in the pits, and I'm real proud of everything, no matter how it turns out.
Reminiscent of Darlington, when you guys won $1 million last year when it began to rain with this very same race car, almost like a review of Darlington.
Maybe this car doesn't think that it can go the full distance. I'm not sure what that means.
Hey, let me ask you, if you were to come in here, if we get resumed, you'll have to make some changes on the car. I heard him say it's tight in the middle and loose coming off. What will you change?
Oh, we're just going to make a few air pressure adjustments, maybe a little bit of wedge, track bar, just some small changes. The car's pretty good. He's been driving real hard to try and stay in the lead because, you know, fresh air was better for him. The 22 held us up a little bit, but I can understand that he was trying to stay in the lead lap. Once the 6 did get by him, the 22 let us go. We appreciate that. They worked with us really well, and we appreciate that.
We'll back away and let you do your rain dance.
Thanks a lot.
You do something too, would you? Okay, Frank Stoddard. By the way, this car that he's driving today, Jeff Burton, won the $1 million last May at Charlotte and another $1 million last September in the rain at Darlington. Let's check in with Bill Weber.
And they've told the teams they're going to park the cars down in turn one. I'm with Jimmy Finnick, crew chief for Mark Martin. I know you love Las Vegas, but you had to gamble there and stay out, didn't you?
Yeah, I mean, everybody had to stay out. The rain's coming, so our car got a little bit tight there and got passed. And I don't know, I wish you'd go back green race. But I don't know, the rain's coming, so we had to stay out.
And you had that information about 4 or 5 laps before the caution came out. I heard, I believe it was Jack Roush say, next time it gets here, it could be here for a while.
Yeah, Jack's been down there checking the weather for us on it, and we could have just got a little bit more. But like I say, Mark was trying. We warned him about it, but the car just got too tight on us.
Okay, your car was tight both in and out, he said.
Yeah, going in, coming out of corner tight, so we're going to fix it, loosen up. But looking at the weather, I don't think we're going to make it today.
Let's hope they're wrong. Let's hope we get it in. Best of luck.
Thank you.
John Kernan.
Well, I'm in Bill Elliott's pit. Bill is up to fourth. Remember, they did a 2-tire change early for track position. It has paid off. Mike Ford is the car chief. And Mike, you opted to stay out there. Do you think this rain's here to stay?
Yeah, it really looks like it's here to stay. Like I said, we took 2 tires there for track position, knowing the rain was going to be here, and we had a long way to go because we didn't get qualified like we'd like to. And going for track position, provided the rain stays, we're hoping it does, it would have paid off for us. This drive-thru crew did a real good job getting him in and out, and hopefully we can pull the top 5 out here.
You spent a lot of changes within this team, crew chief by committee with Bill this year. Are you surprised at how well everything is working so far?
Well, definitely. Go to Daytona for the 500 and come home in third spot. It took us a while. Testing wise, we weren't very good. We all went to work, had a lot of different ideas, but it takes time when you have a lot of new people. Just like this weekend, we unloaded, we weren't very good, didn't get qualified like we would want to, but worked on it a couple more days and we got a real good race car.
It's a brand new race car too. It hadn't even been on the track until Friday, so was it a difficult job to sort it out?
Well, definitely. A lot of these cars came and tested, and like I say, we brought a brand new race car. And there's a lot of learning going on in this pit here.
Well, I think they deserve an A for their first quarter grades.
Team doing a fine job in the year 2000. So the rain comes out and the red flag is being displayed here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway for the second time this afternoon. We had a 20-minute delay earlier. Bill?
And Greg Zipidelli is here. Actually, now he's talking with Mark Cronquist, who's one of the engine builders from Joe Gibbs Racing. Mark is usually down in the 18 pit. He's come down here to talk to Zipidelli, probably talking about what to do with those engines, those motors, if this race goes back to a green flag condition. Obviously, we want to get a word with Greg Zipidelli. And I guess the $64,000 question is, was he supposed to come or was he just bluffing?
Who's that?
Your driver coming down pit road.
No, we talked about it. We were just bluffing. He said he was practicing for maybe someday when it really will count. did a good job, looked good. No, the Home Depot Pontiac's running really good. We were really good yesterday morning in practice, struggled last night, made a whole bunch of changes this morning. Tony's done a great job. Pit stops have been really good today, and hey, we're second. I don't know. I'd like to say we've finished this thing, but I don't know if we're gonna.
Your car has gotten better lap by lap here today.
It seems like we're really good in the long run. We don't give up that much. We maybe not have the speed that the 99 and the 6, and I think they're kind of just playing with us because they can kind of like take off whenever they need to. We're still a little tight in the center. I think we can still make our car a little bit better. Whether it's good enough for the guys around us, I don't know. We'll just keep working on it if we get that opportunity.
If you get that opportunity, will you put some more tape on the nose? Is that something you're thinking about?
I think we're just going to work with maybe the track bar and some air pressure. Aero balance, it seems pretty good behind cars, alongside cars. I hate to screw that up. Everything's damp, rubber on it. I go counting on that, it might fall off, and I'm going to lose it. So if I race the track bar, I know what I got.
Okay, I hope it goes back to green.
Thanks
man.
Greg Zipidelli, the crew chief for Tony Stewart, who currently is in second position to Jeff Burton. The red flag is out, 148 laps of the CarsDirect.com 400 have been completed.
This Y Gated Sports Update brought to you by Mobile One. Nothing outperforms Mobile One. Here now, Robin Roberts.
Well, Mother Nature just not cooperating out in Las Vegas. The CarsDirect.com 400 hopefully will resume in just a moment and will return to Las Vegas. In just a moment. First of all, college hoops. And you know, next Sunday, a week from today, it's Election Sunday. That's when the 64 teams will find out that they're going to the men's and women's NCAA tournaments, or they could find out today by winning their conference titles, like in the Ohio Valley Conference. Southeast Missouri State taking on the favorite, Murray State. Aubrey Reese feeds Rod Murray, and Murray State led by two early on. Second half action, Southeast Missouri State pours it on. Mike Branson nails the three. He had 21, and the celebration is on because Southeast Missouri State is advancing to its first ever men's NCAA tournament with a 67-56 upset over Murray State. Aubrey Reese, the Ohio Valley MVP, only 3 points, 1 of 19 from the field. How about some hockey? Sabres and Caps. Buffalo's Dominic Hasek taking a seat. He gave up 4 goals in the loss last night to the Isles. Jeff Halpern scores on the one-timer from Steve Pennewalchuk. Washington took the first period lead. Then in the third, Olaf Kolzik makes a save on Vavrata's slap shot. And Washington wins this one by a final of 2-1. Kolzik, 28 saves. He's given up only 3 goals in the last 83 shot attempts. So taking a look at the Eastern Conference race right now, 5 teams now with 80 or more points, but still, Buffalo remains 3 points out. The NHL on ABC begins weekly regional coverage March 18th and continues through the playoffs, culminating with the crowning of the Stanley Cup championship. So plenty of NHL action on ABC beginning March 18th. Cannot wait for that. All right, that's our Wide World of Sports mobile update. Thanks for joining us. We'll get back out to Bob Jenkins for more of the CarsDirect.com 400, hopefully in Las Vegas.
Once again, the cars are stopped down in the turn one area. The tarps are on them, and now we see the umbrellas being carried by the NASCAR officials. It is raining here in Las Vegas, and it's raining probably as hard now as it has for a while. It has wetted the track, but still we got a long time to go here, and they do have lights, so hopefully we'll be able to get this entire race in its entirety. Well, Jeff Burton is not unaccustomed to rain, and he is not unaccustomed to winning million-dollar bonuses in the rain. This was last spring at Darlington, South Carolina. He was in the lead, praying for rain, and it did come, and as a result, he won that 400-mile race. Then, in September, with rain also falling, he was in the lead and won the Noble 5 Million. Moments ago, one of his crew members was saying, "Come on, rain, and get this thing over with." Jerry?
And Jeff, it's raining, you're leading, and we're in a red flag situation, and it's $1 million for grabs. We've done this before, say last September.
Well, I hope it has the same results. The X-Side horse is really fast. On a long run, we lost a little bit right there. The 20 car really came on us, and I don't really know what's going on. The 6 car, he's fast. I don't know who else is fast, but we're going to have to be better. When it goes back green, we're going to have to make it a little bit better because the 20 will beat us if we don't.
Are you anticipating it'll get back to green flag racing? You're getting French fries thrown at you by the guy that's chasing on the racetrack, Tony Stewart. And what about if you think we get a chance to go back to green or some your crew chiefs over here doing a rain dance behind us. They're trying to get the rain to come on and move in.
Well, we're hoping we don't, but there's a lot of daylight left here. It's still early in the day, and we have lights here. So, and I know NASCAR will do everything in their power to get it started, and they should. I hope we do go back green, even if we don't win. We need to end these races on the green. But whatever happens is, you know, we've been really competitive. We feel good about what we've got. But again, we've got to make it a little better if we don't win this thing.
And we talked to your crew chief, Frank. He said he would have to make some adjustments on the car if he did make a pit stop because the car is really not to your liking, even though you're running out front.
Well, it's good, but, you know, like I said, the 20 is coming. The 6 is there. I see the 3 is sneaking up. You know, everybody, when you're sitting there leading, everybody has something to gauge off of, and they're sitting there making their cars better. If we don't make our car better, they'll beat us.
Well, let's go over and move up, talk to the guy that's chasing you here for just a moment, and was throwing French fries at you a moment ago, Tony Stewart. Now, I know the deal. You're going to share the French fries. I hope he'll share that $1 million as he's pouring water on both of us here. That was from Jeff Burton, courtesy of Burton. How about your car? You got something for the 99?
I don't know. I'd say we're pretty close. The one I'm worried about is that 6 car. I think he's playing possum today. He ran hard to get to the halfway, and as soon as the halfway was over, he let us go like he had a problem. But I don't know. It's always fun racing Jeff, and you know, we were comparing notes, and his is a little loose off, mine's a little tied off, and if we can beat him to the punch, we might be able to win it. But we got to do the anti-rain dance. I got to find some Indians around here that know how to do the anti-rain dance to get us to show back on the road.
You climbed out of your car, walked over here, said, what's the deal here? It's raining, you're leading, we stopped, and you got $1 million bonus up for grabs. I mean, you got to get some of his kind of luck.
Whatever he's doing it right. So, I don't know. I had a year like that in 95 with USAC, winning 3 championships in the same year where I couldn't do anything wrong. And when it comes to these no-bull races and rain, he's got it down pat. But I don't know. We may have something for him with this Home Depot Pontiac.
Tony, a year ago, this may have been the low point of your rookie season. You guys did not have a great run here, but from here on, after this race and after the disappointment here, you guys were just incredible for the rest of the year. Have you vowed to come back and maybe say, this track owes me one?
Well, this has been a love-hate relationship for me with this speedway, and not only in the Cup Series, but Busch and the IRL. I won an IRL championship here, but I've always run bad here, and the worst wreck I ever had in my career was here in 96 in an IRL car, so... you know, it'd be a nice track to come and finally conquer and kind of get that monkey off my back here. But running second right now, I don't feel too bad about that, but I'd sure like to get one more spot behind us.
Hope you get a chance to get it finished. So thanks for taking a moment.
All right, thank you guys.
Tony Stewart running second right now in the Home Depot Pontiac. Let's check in on the Jeff Gordon situation with Bill Weber.
Well, Jeff is here. He's been talking with Robbie Loomis and Brian Weitzel, and I'll step under here because it's a little drier. Thank you very much, sir. Been a tough day.
Yeah, been a real tough day. You know, we were starting on the outside, and the car got real loose there early on, and had some guys in front of me just really sideways, and we went backwards, and I got real loose, and I just couldn't get it back, and then we came into pit, and that just put us so far back. I actually feel like we're not bad right now. I just hate we lost that lap because I think we could really make up some spots if we hadn't have done that.
Your team did do a lot of work on pit road, Jeff. Can you walk us through a little bit of what went on there?
Well, we're just so loose getting up off, that we need to tighten it up, get some drive off. And I can't even describe all the changes that we made. But I know pulling that spring rubber out of that right rear really helped it. And then just messing around a lot with air pressure. It's unfortunate. You know, we got a much better car than we're able to show right now. But hey, you can't start off that loose, you know, with as competitive as it is.
Tough start to this season.
Yeah, you know, hey, we're here for the long haul, buddy. We're going to be working hard. We're going to get it together. And this is not going to get us down, I can tell you that.
And you have a track next week on the schedule that I know you run very well at.
Yeah, you know, we've had some great runs at Atlanta. I think that we got to throw a lot of our setups that we've had in the past kind of out the window with this new Monte Carlo. Just, it's a different monster. It wants a lot of different things, and I've got to drive it a little bit different too, but I think it should be halfway decent at Atlanta.
And a new tire here at this race to throw you a curve as well.
Yeah, but we tested here and thought we tested pretty good, and I don't really think that's throwing us a curve much.
All right, well, we'll see you at Atlanta. May I see you later today too if this ever stops.
Yeah, I'm not sure if I want to go back green or if I want to run. I'm just starting to kind of have some fun, but I just say we got that lap down.
Okay, Jeff, thanks for your time.
Thank you.
Jeff Gordon talking it over with Robbie Loomis, Brian Weitzel, and the rest of his crew here on Pit Road as the rain continues to fall. And speaking of rain, John Kernan is our acting meteorologist, and he has an update. John?
Yeah, acting meteorologist. I'm not licensed by any board or anything, but it doesn't take a rocket scientist to look at this and say, "Yeah, it's going to rain." The only glimmer of hope that as we look at this, because it spreads out 100 miles right there, 150 miles, and then all the way over here into the Los Angeles area, Southern California, a lot of moisture moving this way. You've got the mountains that can tend to kind of hold it back, and also you've just got the light green, which is light rain, and sometimes that light rain is not necessarily falling all the way to the surface of the earth. However, we know from standing outside here that the light rain around us up here in Las Vegas, it actually is making its way to the surface. But just looking at this, I don't have a lot of hope. But the good thing about being, you know, a weatherman or predicting weather is you don't have to be right all the time. Bob?
That's right. And if you're not right, well, nobody really complains. But I do hope they get this thing restarted. Let's take a look at a Napa field summary where they are running at the conclusion of 148 laps and another rain delay. It's Burton, Stewart, Martin, Elliott, Labonte, and Johnny Benson running in the top five. It's really been a very safe race. We have had no cautions as a result of crashes. We do have one car out of the race, as we will see when we look at the rest of the running order right now. 16 through 30. We'll show you that the 36 car of Kenny Schrader is running 16th. 19 cars are on the lead lap. We talked with Jeff Gordon just a few moments ago. You see him there in 28th position. Steve Park is the only driver out of the race. He retired the number one Pennzoil Chevy a few minutes ago. We're at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. I'm Bob Jenkins along with Ray Evernham, Benny Parsons, Bill Weber, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch. And it is raining in this third race of the 2000 NASCAR Winston Cup season. Once again, Jeff Burton is the leader of the race. Back after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching the CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
The CarsDirect.com 400 NASCAR Winston Cup race here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway is in its second rain delay. We had a 20-minute delay earlier, and now the track is a little bit wetter than it was earlier, and so this is going to be a much lengthier one. Because we do have the car stopped down there in the Turn 1 area, and it's probably the only sport that we will be able to talk to a competitor during the actual running of the event. We're just past the halfway mark. We've talked to Jeff Burton and Tony Stewart. They're running first and second. Running third is Mark Martin.
Mark, a race car looks to be pretty good for you today. Are you comfortable in the car? As you said, obviously it's raining now, but is the car on the racetrack pretty comfortable to you?
Car's been great today. You know, it's been working well. Burton is really fast, and we're keeping our eye on the target here. You know, this thing gets going again, we've got a car that can contend.
We talked about the fact that your car, a couple of times, they looked like it lost power or slowed dramatically on the racetrack, and then it didn't pick back up. What was that about?
Well, one time I remember for sure, early in the race, when I went after Jeff Burton for the lead, I was behind and I was catching him. My car, you know, is picking up a little bit of a push off the corner. I tried to power through that, and it didn't work. The car got out right on the edge of the marbles. And, you know, I had to shut it down. And with the straightaways this long, it's really critical to get off these corners with good momentum. And it broke the momentum, and, you know, I slowed down. I got to preserve that piece, you know. It could give me what I need to win this thing. And we got a great car there, and, you know, we got a lot of competition. This race has potential to really be something. Bill Elliott's running great, and what a crowd favorite that would be if he could get up there and contend. And I think that Tony Stewart's maybe one adjustment away from being really hard to handle. Jeff Burton's really strong. You know, I see the 18 car back there. He's coming along. This thing could get interesting.
Tony Stewart said that he thinks you might be playing with him a little bit. You really have the car to beat and may have backed off and let he and your teammate Burton go by. Are you playing a little possum, or is the car just a car going away here late in the run?
It went away in that run. We did manage to get to the front there in the traffic. Jeff was having a little trouble passing his brother and probably thought that I might have a little bit better luck at it than he. And, you know, the car, once I got out front, it was good there for a little bit, but it gave up a little bit, and we've got a little bit of adjusting to do to the thing to really make it stay with us all the way to the end of a gas run. It runs pretty strong in the middle of the run. It's not the quickest car on new tires, and it's not the quickest car at the end, but in the middle of the run, she's pretty strong.
I know you're proud of your run today, but you're very proud of your son, Matt, who for the first time last night in a B main, first time ever, finished second, I'm told, in Orlando.
That was Friday night. Yeah, he moved up to junior Honda, and it's a little bit more of a challenge than the novice class that he was racing in last year. So I was real proud of him. He did real well.
Hey, good luck today, and good luck. If we restart this thing, good luck out there, and we'll see what happens.
Thanks. We're looking forward to it. I hope it gets started again.
Got a million reasons he wants to see this one get back to green flag racing. Let's check in up in the Johnny Benson pits with Bill.
Well, earlier in the week here in Vegas, some of the sports books had Johnny Benson at 75-1 and 60-1. Not that I would know personally, but I heard from good sources. But you've had another outstanding day.
I tell you what, these guys here, Tyler Jump Motorsports team, are just doing an awesome job. And the cars are great, good quality, good driving. Man, I tell you, James Inch, all the guys here in the Lycos Pontiac are just doing a great job. And it's making life a lot of fun right now.
Oh, you were doing a great job out there on the track. Tell me about your day.
I only hit one guy, I think, but so it was. Yeah, I mean, it got pretty slippery there when it was raining, just sliding around a little bit, and I'd have liked to have seen it go another 8-10 more laps, see if it couldn't get an orange spoiler on this car, but you know, we'll take six right now, and if it rains out, fine, and we'll go to Atlanta.
Obviously, the top five eligible for the Noble Million when we get to Charlotte. Boy, you talk about gambles. You took a big one. You walked away from a successful organization, came over to a team that had no sponsor and really a very limited past, and you guys have gotten out of the gate in fantastic shape.
Yeah, we have. Like I say, James Inch, all the guys, man. I mean, I couldn't ask for them guys to do a better job than what they're doing. And, you know, good quality race cars. And I saw that first time I walked through the shop, and I said, man, if I make this happen, this is where it needs to be. And I say, Tim Beverly took a chance on throwing me in the car, and you know, we're just glad that Lycos come on board and looking forward to the next 31 races.
Gambles that have paid off. If we go back to green, best of luck. Otherwise, we'll see you at Atlanta.
All right, thank you.
Johnny Benson currently sixth as we sit in a rain delay here in Las Vegas. John?
Well, we saw earlier in the race, Sterling Marlin's team opt for a two-tire change to get track position. They got up to third, but then Sterling, after you got the tires worn down a little bit, had some other cars passing you. Do you guys still fighting that downforce problem, the balance with the Chevys?
Yeah, a little bit. It's a deal where you're either tight or loose, and we really can't get the car pinned down. Scott, my crew chief, asked me, so what are you going to do? And I said, I can't tell you nothing to do. One lap it pushes, one lap it's loose, and you're running the same line. So we just got to get the cars balanced better somehow, and you know, maybe NASCAR will work with us and give us something. So we'll see what happens.
What about next week in Atlanta? Do you feel that you guys will be at a big disadvantage there?
Well, it's a pretty fast track. You know, they run 192, 94 now qualifying, and, you know, the Ford's pretty slick, Pontiac's pretty slick, and we don't know till we get there, so we'll just you know, work hard as we can with the Coors team and see what happens, and maybe we'll get there.
What about this race right now? You ready to go home, or you want it to get back underway, or what's your professional opinion? I've already given mine.
Well, we're about as good as we're going to get at 18th, so I'm ready to get out of here.
All right, thank you, okay. Sterling.
Hey, I'd like to say, still on there?
Yeah, I think so.
Say happy birthday to my little daughter. She's 10 today, so happy birthday, Stella.
All right, happy birthday, Bob.
Well, Sterling talked about running next weekend at Atlanta. We'll show you the schedule because we will televise that race. It'll begin with Bud Pohl qualifying Friday on ESPN2 at 5 o'clock Eastern Time. The NASCAR Busch Series race on Saturday will be here on ABC at 1. Our happy hour coverage on ESPN2 at 6 o'clock Eastern Time on Saturday. Then on Sunday, RPM Today at noon, NASCAR Today at 12:30, both on ESPN2. The Cracker Barrel 500 from Atlanta Motor Speedway hits the air at 1 o'clock next Sunday afternoon here on ABC. And the RPM Tonight program at 9 o'clock Sunday night on ESPN2. And then following our coverage of the Winston Cup race next Sunday, you can see the very first race of the International Race of Champions, which was held in Daytona. You can see it next Sunday at 5 o'clock after our coverage of the Winston Cup race.
And folks, that was a fantastic IROC race.
Bob Jenkins, Ray Evernham, and I were doing that race. And by the way, Ed Clark from Atlanta Motor Speedway stopped by just a moment ago, said, folks, want to see a good race? Some tickets still left in Atlanta.
Back at Las Vegas in a moment. Rain continues to fall here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. Not a heavy rain, but the track, as you can see, is now totally saturated. And this race is stopped for the second time. Well, Ricky Rudd had high hopes coming into this race. He started from the pole position. Let's get his thoughts as he is now in 12th from him and Bill.
Ricky, you did have high hopes for today. How's your car right now?
Well, Bill, it seems like we've done it about 3 weeks in a row. We start off not too good, and then we get dialed in as the race goes on. We're actually on the pit board. We're pretty racy. We're sitting there 12th in line, but we're reeling in the guys in front of us, and I don't think we'll win the race, but we're a top five car if we can restart the race and go out there and race. But I don't know. We'll have to wait and see. Hope the weather holds out.
You did tell us earlier in the weekend that is one thing you guys are working on, the long runs.
Well, it's not going to happen overnight. You know, you go to qualify, and you have a lot of horsepower under the hood, and you put on a new set of tires, and driver can go out there and just drive it down in a corner, and if it sticks, and just for that one split second, and you can get back into gas, you'll have a quick lap, and that's what we've been able to do. And it's not that we're handling bad, it's just that we handle better towards the end of the race than we do the front of the race, and we just need to figure that out so we can start the race a little bit better shape. But it's coming. It's going to take a little while, but it's coming.
How long is a little while in that kind of a situation, Ricky?
3 or 4 weeks.
Yeah. And this is three.
Yeah. Well, 3 or 4 weeks from now.
Oh, okay.
Goodbye a little time.
Because you and your crew chief, although you have worked together, you're basically with a whole new team.
Well, it's a new team. It's a new race car. You know, it's a new Taurus, and it has some different characteristics that the old Taurus didn't have in it. And it just takes a while to work those things out. I know they've been in the wind tunnel a couple of times and trying to learn something. And like I say, it's coming, but basically it's sort of a brand new race team pulled together. And I'm happy with the results, and we're running well at the end, but we just got to figure it out so we can get running a little bit better at the front of the race.
Okay, we'll keep watching. Best of luck.
Okay, thank you, Bill.
That's Ricky Rudd, currently 12th on the pole. Let's go to Jerry.
Well, Derek Cope, it may be raining, it may be cold, and wind may be blowing, but it's a sunny day for this Finley Moore team because you guys got some great news this morning.
That's true. We got a sponsorship for the next two races with everythingcommerce.com and with an option to go on for the full year. So things look real good. We'd like to have a little better day for them today, but you know, we're going to a place that's really good for us in Atlanta, and hopefully we can showcase what we can do down there.
We followed your progress in Daytona, and you guys were incredible down there. I mean, the team put back together, Bud Moore, the veteran, Joey Knuckles, the crew chief, and you get early Elliott Motors, and you guys were a factor in every practice session and ran well in the qualifying race.
Well, we ran really good down there. The car was excellent. The guys had worked really hard over the winter. And then, you know, obviously we knew we were on a limited schedule. And then, you know, we knew we had to procure funding so we could continue on. But that was a great motivator for us at Daytona. So it showed that we could run up front and vie for a win, be in a position to win races. And that's what you have to do. So, you know, we didn't really live up to it today as well as I'd like to have. But Atlanta's a good place for me. I've led races there and run good and finished fifth a couple years ago. So hopefully we'll go there and we can showcase everything on commerce.com real well the next week.
So Las Vegas, Atlanta. Now, what happens after Atlanta as far as the limited schedule you're going to run? Or will you make a decision in Atlanta as far as future sponsorship with these people or races?
They've got an option, a first right of refusal for the full sponsorship for the remainder of the year. So they have looked at this thing. They really think it's a great vehicle for them. They need the awareness, the brand awareness for everythingcommerce.com, and they feel like it's a great opportunity. So, you know, we must want to showcase our potential for them, show them that we're, you know, definitely worth having them on board. And if we can do that, then hopefully they'll make a decision right after Atlanta whether to come on or not, and then we can obviously go on from there.
And good luck on the progress. Thanks for taking a moment to come by and join us.
Thank you, Jerry. Appreciate it.
Derek Cope, 1990 winner of the Daytona 500, gets a sponsorship and back on the circuit possibly full-time after this week.
Derek did have a really good run at Daytona. Started 12th. The finishing position of 41st was certainly not an indication of how well that team performed during the entire speed weeks at Daytona. Big spray being raised from the back of those trucks circulating Las Vegas Motor Speedway, so we do have a very wet racetrack and a little bit of moisture continuing to fall here just north of downtown Las Vegas. We'll be back with more of our live coverage of the Cars Direct.com 500. Back at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, the CarsDirect.com 400, Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where it is under a rain delay. Not a whole lot of rain falling right now, but we have a very wet racetrack.
Keep up to date on everything that's happening in NASCAR, whether it be in Winston Cup or any other division, by visiting the official NASCAR website at www.nascar.com. Well, the road to the Visa Triple Crown Challenge on ABC begins Saturday. We get an early look at some of this year's top three-year-olds as they run for victory in the 49th Florida Derby. It's Saturday at 5:30 Eastern and Pacific here on ABC, the home of the Kentucky Derby. Let's go to John Kernan, who's with Dale Earnhardt Jr.
Dale Jr., led a lot of laps today. You must have had a lot of fun out there so far.
Yeah, well, it was a lot of fun. We got to kind of run competitively for a while, but the Budweiser Chevrolet got a little tight on long runs, and we've made some adjustments. We've kind of improved it to where we can hang with the 88 and the 3 and those guys that were in front of us. So we're not losing as much ground as we were on long runs. Maybe if we can get this thing dried up and get going again, we can adjust on it even more and get ourselves back in the top five.
So you're one of the drivers who want to get back out there, right?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, either way, it doesn't matter to me. It's a long ride home, so... there's no big rush for me.
2.5 races into your rookie season on the Winston Cup circuit. Are you having fun now? Is there a lot of pressure to it, a lot of things to do?
I'm having a good time, but we still are very focused on getting our car better in race trim. I mean, we're doing good. We're qualifying well, and we're doing good there, but we're having some trouble in race trim, and I don't know whether it's just Rockingham's bad for everybody, but I thought we'd come here and run good, and we had. We're kind of up front a little bit, but we need to stay there, you know. We need to stick around the whole race.
This was one of the tracks you were looking forward to coming here because of your experience here, right? You figured that you'd do really well.
Well, we tested here, and that really gave me a lot of confidence because we tested well, and I was very comfortable in the car. So, and I still am. I mean, we just, like I said, 60, 70 laps into the tire run, those guys are still going fast, and we're pushing the right front off.
Now, early in the race when you were leading, and you looked back behind you and saw your old rival from the Busch Series, Matt Kenseth, behind you, what went through your mind?
I had no worries at all because I know how clean a racer Matt is, so I didn't worry. But it was a few of them other fellas, when they get in the mirror, you worry about. But I know Matt's gonna do smart things on the racetrack, and you ain't got to worry about it. Even if, you know, I knew sooner or later he's gonna get around me or something like that. That's gonna happen. But he's got a good car today too. He just needs, just like us, a few more adjustments.
Well, Dale Earnhardt Jr. looking for a successful rookie season. And now to his father, who's, what, 7-time Winston Cup champion. He's had several very successful seasons. He's with Jerry Punch.
All right, and we are back here with Dale Earnhardt Sr., just talking to Earnhardt Jr. a moment ago. Now, his car runs well early in the short runs, but as you continue to go on, your car gets better and better and better, and you just went right on by.
Yeah, well, you know, I've been pacing myself. We got a little break here, and we get some clear weather. You know, I've had a Coca-Cola and a snack well, and a Nabisco snack well, so I'm ready to go if we get this rain out of here.
You might not get to finish that cookie off. We got Corky here on the camera. He's pretty hungry.
I'll give him a pack, man. I'll give you a pack.
your race car, obviously, we watched you some lap times. You and Bill Elliott were the two fastest cars on the racetrack after about 30, 35 laps. I mean, the car comes on after about the middle part of the run, it seems to.
Yeah, and we went and adjusted on it, and boy, we really messed it up for this last run. I got so loose and getting in three, but we're going to go back on this restart and adjust back the other way and be happy with it. We made some last-minute changes this morning, Kevin and I, and the car is basically like we started with it in practice, and we hadn't really changed anything, and we just did a little rubber here and a little of this on the spring, a little shoring up the spring a little bit, and I think we're in pretty good shape, and then we adjusted in the last pit stop and really made it loose. So we're going to go back to where we were.
Enjoying having Junior in the Winston Cup Series. I mean, I know you guys talk a lot, and you got you own the race cars. And so do you learn something from having the extra cars to be able to do R&D with?
Yeah, we do. Pennzoil Park and Dale Jr. and Budweiser has been it's really helped Dale Earnhardt and Richard Childress and Mike Skinner to improve the Monte Carlo and improve the aerodynamics on our program. So we just keep improving. Maybe we can improve right to the front. But it's fun having your kid out there racing, too. And I was really upset with the Park's engine breaking. But, hopefully we can rebound and get him some running better. But It is good to see a kid running good and racing with him. As a matter of fact, he's just a couple cars behind me. He's making his move back to the front, so I got to adjust and go faster, too.
Now that you're an owner and you got all those people you're responsible for, what about team curfews? Do you put curfews on these young kids that like to go out and play a little bit or not? They're both still single and both enjoying life a little bit. Do you have to keep them under wraps a little bit as sort of the senior member and the guy that's got all this investment for them?
I have to watch Park as much as I do Dale Jr. Both of them are, they like to enjoy themselves and go out. And Park rides a motorcycle and does a lot of this and that, but they're pretty good guys. They get in early on race night and get ready.
Speaking of enjoying yourselves, you seem to be having as much fun this year as I've seen in a long, long time. Great at Daytona, really had a good time in Rockingham. Are you just more relaxed, or are you just excited about the fact this could be the 8th Winston Cup Championship you've been waiting for?
Well, I feel good. You know, last year we were, and I think even before, I think my neck was giving me trouble, and I didn't realize it. And I feel a lot better now, and I'm ready to go racing. And the car, the Monte Carlo itself, I think is a better race car than I had last year, and it gets in the corner good and nice, and it really lends itself to the way I drive race cars. So we'll see what it does.
I can't let you go without mentioning the guy that we all miss, and we all wouldn't be here if it weren't for him, and that's Bill French Jr. I know, watching back in Daytona, I know we all send our prayers and best wishes out to him. I know you speak with him quite a lot, but in Daytona, when you won that IROC race and you walked out of victory lane up there and handed him the trophy and gave him a big hug, I know that meant a lot to you as well as to him.
Well, it was, and to see him at the racetrack was great, just to see him there, but to have him up and moving around, and I think he's fighting it, and I think he's winning the battle. And we're all praying that he does. I talked to him the other day, and I think Friday or Saturday, and he had been out on his boat fishing in West Palm a little bit, so he snuck away, and I think Betty Jane's probably going to get on him when she finds out where he went.
Well, we're all wishing the best. Dale, good luck to you if we get started racing. If not, we'll see you in Atlanta.
All right, we look forward to it.
Dale Earnhardt Sr., of course, we all send our best wishes out to Bill French Jr., battling that cancer back in Daytona. Hurry back, Bill.
Well, Dale Earnhardt finished second at Rockingham last week and as a result made the largest advance in points from last week. He was 21st going into Rockingham and comes into this race in 7th position in the point standings with Bobby Labonte leading. More after these messages and a word from our ABC stations.
You're watching the CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC's Wide World of Sports.
Welcome back live to Las Vegas Motor Speedway, the CarsDirect.com 400 under a rain delay here. It hasn't rained for a while, at least here on the front stretch, and the track is drying, but it will be a while before we can go back to racing. We showed you the points before we went to break. Those are the points right now. So at the moment, if this race were to end and not go back to green, Bobby Labonte would be the points leader. Bill?
And Bobby Labonte is back here in the garage behind his rig. Obviously, you've had a good run to a certain extent to this point.
Yeah, it's not bad. We run in the top five, I guess, most of the day. And we're just trying to fine-tune our car to get it a little bit better like a couple other cars, but haven't been able to yet. And if we do get back to running again, can we get it better? I'm not sure. Hopefully we can. But we're sitting here right now. Fifth's not a bad place to be if it had to be raining. And knowing that we weren't as good to be, we weren't good enough to be up, first or second right now. But hopefully we'll get it dialed in. If we do go back to racing, we won't screw it up. And if we don't, we'll take fifth.
If it does not restart unofficially, you would be the points leader at this point after three races.
Well, that's really important, isn't it? After three races.
After three. 31 to go,
yeah.
Bob.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's okay.
We could change that. We could make it 25th if you'd like that better.
No, it's okay. I do pretty good at that myself, probably. But anyway, we're enjoying that right there. We've got some good consistent runs out of the first three races. So we're just trying to make it through. And if we make it through today in top five, that's great. If we go back to racing and we screw it up, then that's our own fault. But hopefully we can get it good. Got to say hi to Joe. He's back with his mom, and just want to tell him hello. And we're still doing okay.
Obviously, though, every point is important, and you have won a race already this season, and the fact that you would be number one shows that your team is not only winning but consistent through the first three.
Yeah, I mean, that's still 31 races to go, but we have hopefully built a lot of that up, and, if we can just keep digging, then, hopefully it'll pay off.
Just one more question. Did you guys make a gear change on the car this morning?
Yeah, just a couple points, nothing big. We just thought we saw a little RPM off yesterday, so we thought we'd try it.
How does that work out?
It's okay. I mean, we really don't, you know, probably a little bit better in the longer run than in a short run. But, you know, so really, I think it might have washed out, kind of washed,
equaled out. Thanks, Bobby.
Okay, well, let's wash out today.
We'll see. Right now it is certainly under a red flag here at Las Vegas. Bobby Labonte currently fifth here as we sit in the rain. John?
And one driver who wished that the rain would have held off about 5.5 minutes is Robbie Gordon, because everybody was scheduled to come into pit, and he was off sequence. That would have put him in the lead. But, Robbie, right now you're 13th. That's not too bad.
We're not too bad, actually. If it does go back green, if we get the opportunity to go racing, we think we have a pretty good race car. This will probably be the time that we'll go back and get on sequence with everybody else. You know, we made some changes last night in the car. Crew did a really good job implementing those changes, and the car's pretty competitive.
You've qualified for the three races, brand new team, run well, led laps today. Are you amazed at how well this team has come together? Because this is something you put together late last fall.
Well, at least one of our goals is to at least put a competitive race team together, and we're not straying from that. We're going to work very hard until we do have a competitive race team. You know, we're closing in on it. We haven't met our final expectations by any means. We have a long ways to go. You know, we're just barely getting inside the top 15, but we keep working hard enough at it. I think we'll climb up the ladder a bit.
Robbie Gordon wanting to get back out there on the racetrack today, Bob.
He had his best start of the year here at Las Vegas, a 12th, and currently is running in 13th position to match the number on the side of his car. We'll take another break and be back with more live coverage in just a moment from Las Vegas Motor Speedway.
The CarsDirect.com 400 on ABC Sports, brought to you by Haviland. Add more life to your car. Frost Brute Coors Light, who reminds you the three most important words are hey, beer, man. And Red Wing Shoes, work hard.
I'm Bob Jenkins, back live at Las Vegas Motor Speedway, where the rain delay continues. All cars resting down in the turn one area of this 1.5 mile facility. Well, let's update you on where everybody is running right now in a Napa field summary. And Jeff Burton is at the front of the field right now with Tony Stewart running in second, then Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, who's had a great run. Bobby Labonte is fifth. Johnny Benson, we talked with him a little bit earlier. He's running sixth, followed by Dale Jarrett, Dale Earnhardt, and Joe Nemechek, with Dale Earnhardt Jr. running in the 10th position. Here now is 16 through 30. There are 19 cars on the lead lap, and Jeff Gordon is not among them. He has lost a lap, finds himself in 28th spot. Now the remainder of the running field, Terry Labonte running in 31st position, and Steve Park, the only car officially out of the race with an engine problem. 148 laps have been completed out of 267, so we are past the halfway point. When we come back, we will talk to Rusty Wallace and to Bill Elliott, so stay with us for more from Las Vegas. Rain delay continues at Las Vegas Motor Speedway with Jeff Burton, the leader of the race. Bill Elliott has once again been very impressive. He's running in fourth position currently. Here is John Kernan.
And they made that two-tire change early in the race to get track position, and then, Bill, your car took off and was actually running faster than some of the guys who had changed four tires. Could you believe that?
I couldn't believe it. I told the guys, I started to call up and tell my spotter to tell Dale Jarrett not to run over me when it started, because I was concerned about what it was going to do whenever we started back. But, you know, I worked the tires in good. I drove off down in turn one. I said, man, this thing sticks good. And, I mean, we dug on. I kept watching Dale, you know, a little bit in the mirror, and, you know, I kept getting just a little bit of time on him. And then we run our, you know, a fairly long time, and, you know, Mark and Jeff got away a little bit. And then, man, this thing started back, run them back down from a good way. Got to them, I couldn't do nothing with them, but... I mean, still, it says a lot from where we started to where we're at right now. I mean, if this thing don't go another lick, or, you know, we end up, they start back and we totally messing up. But, you know, all in all, it's been a good day to this point. And, you know, we just, you know, need to do something and decide what they're going to do and let us get home and, you know, worry about next week.
It's a resurgence of sorts for Bill Elliott this year. Is it just the changes? Is it the chemistry within the team and these guys you have working with you now?
Well, you know, we've made quite a few changes on the team as far as crew member wise, and they've really stepped up to the plate. I mean, they've put in a lot of long hours, and, you know, we put a lot of effort into Daytona, and it really paid off. And we hadn't put as much effort which we have after the fact into our, you know, short track program, such as here in Rockingham. And I was, when we came in here, I said, man, we have got to go somewhere and test, because I said, we just seem to be so far behind on this stuff. And then we kept working with the car, and, you know, we made some changes this morning, and race started, and it was good.
It's very good. Right now, currently running fourth as we continue to watch the rain fall here in the garage area. To Dr. Jerry Punch with Rusty Wallace.
And this is the way to do an interview in a rain delay, when it's raining and cold outside and nice inside a nice, beautiful coach with this cushioned leather. Rusty, thanks for letting us come in and enjoy your hospitality. First of all, the race car today, you sit 15th on the grid right now, but you've been battling a pretty significant handling problem.
Yeah, I was real happy with the car when I started the race. It felt real good. Then after that first set of tires, I've been tight ever since. And so if we get back green, which I hope we can, we're going to make some major adjustments to get that thing turning better, because I think I still got a great car. I just got to adjust on it.
You worked all weekend here. Was it you're trying to get the car better, and right before qualifying, the car got much, much better than you had been during practice. Is the weather change today the reason we're seeing so many guys have problems like you are with getting the car to turn coming off?
I think so. The cooler it gets, the more the car's pushed, the front end, they always do. And so it's getting real cool right now, real cold, and as we get through the day, the cars just start pushing the front end harder and harder and harder. And as that happens, unless you have a bunch of caution flags out there, you just got to deal with it. And the cars that are really hooked up are going to the front, and the cars that are struggling are going to the back, and there's a caution flag needing to be thrown. I mean, I was hoping for a caution real quick to start working on my car.
Talked to your buddy Dale Earnhardt a moment ago and interrupted his snack in the afternoon there, having some crackers. And it seems like a year for the veterans. You've had a great beginning this year, fourth at Daytona, 11th at Rockingham, fifth in the points. I mean, you've got a good shot at that second championship for Rusty Wallace.
Yeah, you're darn right. I feel like I got a great crew behind me, and we're looking really good. Daytona was great. It was like a Cinderella weekend. We were in the top five the whole week down there. Ran good in qualifying, qualified fifth, run good in the 125s, the 500. Everything was great. Go next week to Rockingham, get a new track record, and had problems in the pits late in the race, and I lost a lap because of a loose lug nut. But I tell you what, we had good cars all year long, and this car I got here is a good car. We just got to get adjusting on it.
Now the bad news, I understand, just across from us here, Roger Penske has looked at the radar, and it looks pretty like we're pretty much socked in.
Well, it's looking pretty green right now. We've got onboard radar here in the bus, and it's looking pretty socked in, but you never know. We just might find one of those wonderful NASCAR sucker holes in the weather, and we'll try for it.
That's Rusty Wallace waiting for the rain to go away, hopefully.
But we still have a rainy situation here in Las Vegas and a very wet racetrack. We're going to be going back to our ABC Wide World of Sports studio in just a moment. Due to our extensive rain delay, we are going to unfortunately be unable to bring you additional coverage from here at Las Vegas Motor Speedway. We urge you to stay tuned to the ESPN networks and your local news for any updates that might occur from here in Las Vegas. There is a real question mark right now as to whether this race will indeed start once again, because we see a lot of dark skies and even rain off in the distance. So right now we don't know whether we're going to get this rain started once again, but we will be unable to bring you any additional coverage from here in Las Vegas. So stay tuned for the ESPN networks and your local news to find out what indeed is going on here at the CarsDirect.com 400, which has been plagued by rain all day. 148 laps have been completed out of 267. Jeff Burton, the leader. Tony Stewart, second. Mark Martin, Bill Elliott, and Bobby Labonte. Now let's go to our Wide World of Sports studio in New York. Here is your host, Robin Roberts.